and welcome to the National Speedway Stadium here in Manchester for tonight's meeting between the Bellevue Aces and the Sheffield Tigers in the Sports Insure Premiership. A very good evening to you for what is a monumentous night in British Speedway. I'm sure you've heard the news. Three-time world champion Ty Wiffenden is back on UK shell. Calvin Tatum, huge for Sheffield Tigers, but also huge for the sport in this country.
Yeah, it's smashing, isn't it? You know, such a charismatic figure back in the sport. Hasn't ridden in the UK since 2016, which is quite some time ago now. So, yeah, a real coup for the sport. And, of course, with Simon Stead putting that call in, obviously, it's paid big dividends. So delighted to see him back.
And unfortunate for Jack Holder because he's been going so well for the Tigers, but also in the Grand Prix Series as well.
Yeah, he's been having a season, well, a fabulous season. And so unfortunate in the Speedway World Cup to have broken his wrist. So not quite sure how long he's going to be out. But obviously, from our perspective, we wish him all the best and he has a speedy recovery. But Ty being here, of course, is huge news.
And like you say, with that charisma, he brings that stardust with him.
Yeah, he sprinkles the stuff around wherever he goes, doesn't he? So, yeah, it's great, you know, and there's no doubt he's a fan favourite. There'll be plenty of people here this evening, you know, very keen to see him race tonight.
Well, let's hear from the man himself then. Ty Wiffenden is with Scott Nichols.
Ty Wiffenden, it's been a few years since we've seen you on UK soil. We're excited. How excited are you to be here?
Yeah, really excited. I'm actually really looking forward to it. When was at the World Cup and obviously Jack got injured, Steady just said to me, oh, do you fancy doing 28 days? And I went, yeah, why not? So I don't think he was expecting that answer, but here we are.
Expect the unexpected. It's only a short-term spell, but obviously the injury to Jack Holder, but what was the attraction to come back to the UK?
I just have a bit of fun, man. Like, I'm pretty busy at the moment with the schedule, but I live here, so if I'm flying back anyway, I might as well, like, instead of going from Poland to Sweden on a Monday and sat in the van all day, I might as well ride and get another day in. So that was the thought process. It was a very quick decision after a few bevvies after the event, and here we are.
Well, I guess it's just exciting to have some time on the bike, have some fun, and get geared up for the Grand Prix.
Yeah, for sure, man. Like, you know, the atmosphere is so chilled here. I forgot kind of what British League was like. You know, there's no stress. Everyone's happy. Everyone's talking. It's a cool atmosphere to be around. And, yeah, looking forward to tonight's race and see how we get on.
Well, thanks, Chang. Enjoy. Go well tonight.
Thank you.
And there is a great atmosphere in the pits tonight. Calvin, can we get ahead of ourselves? Can
Absolutely.
Can we see him ride in a full season here in the UK next year?
I'd like to think so. He's living, as he's just said with Scotty, he's living here now. He's moved back from Poland. And he actually mentioned to Scott in one of the GPs that he was keen to ride here next year. So I think there's every chance, and that would be fabulous news.
Obviously, he knows Bellevue from Speedway of Nations, but Sheffield on Thursday hasn't ridden there for like 14 or 15 years.
No, incredible that, actually, when you say that stat. But it's a big, fast track, and Ty's brilliant around them. I'm sure he'll settle down quite quickly. Slightly different surfaces here, so bike setup may be a little bit challenging early on, but I don't think it'll take too long to get to grips with it.
And it could be a challenging night for you on Thursday, Calvin, because he wants you to go jet skiing with him first.
Yeah, I may not be available. I'm quite worried about it.
You'll have to find an excuse quick.
Yes, absolutely.
Well, let's see where we are in terms of the championship table, because we are reaching the business end of the season, of course. It is Bellevue who lead the way, although they have raced more meetings than anyone else, four more than second place Wolverhampton. Leicester, who are in action tonight against Wolves, are in third. Sheffield are in fourth. Ipswich are equal on points, but have raced five more meetings than the Tigers. Kingsland are in sixth. Peterborough Panthers, so much change going on there. They're trailing at the bottom of the table. But here in Manchester, let's join Scott Nichols now, who's with the captains.
Yeah, thanks, Abby. Indeed, I have two captains with me. I'm going to come to Sheffield captain Kyle Howarth first. Kyle, you got a 10-point lead tonight, but those playoff places are still up for grabs, so you can't afford to slip up.
No, definitely. We want to come here, get the win and get the bonus point. We need to push up on the table now. It's obviously coming to the business end of the season. We've all had a few rain-offs, so people are catching up with each other and it's getting a bit tight up there. So we could do with a big win today, and there's no reason why we can't.
No, definitely not. Ipswich are just outside that top four position, but they've had a good run of form. But you guys do have a lot of home meetings in hand.
Yeah, I think we've got four or five matches on hand in them now. And we've got today, and then we've got four matches at home this month. So we need to make the most of what we've got and take it with both hands. But like I said just then, there's no reason why we can't, and finish top and go from there.
Thanks, Carl. Come to Bellevue, Captain Brady. Brady, you boys are sitting pretty, obviously defending champions, but you're safe in that spot, so obviously there's still a lot of motivation, though, to finish top and go into that playoffs to showing some dominant form.
Yeah, for sure. It's been a strong season for us so far, and yeah, we're enjoying it. We've got a great side, and things have been going well for us, but I think Sheffield's probably the only team that's really put it over us repeatedly this year, so we're definitely looking for a strong win today.
So it's going to be a good one, and importantly, there's always that coin toss and gate position, so I'm going to give a coin a toss and get you to call, Kyle. Come down tail, so your choice, one and three in heat one, should I say, or heat 15?
We'll go with heat 15, please.
Okay, so they're going to go heat 15, so it's your choice in heat one, Kyle.
One and three.
Okay, there you have it. The Sheffield Tigers go 1-3 in heat one. Back to you, Abby.
Scotty, thank you. Let's head to trackside now. It's a lovely evening here in Manchester to see what the track is like with Kelv.
Always a delight to come to the National Speedway Stadium, and I must say, it's also a delight to see the sun in the sky after the foul weather that we've had recently. The track actually took a bit of a beating on Saturday with the flat track Grand Prix, and I know that Andy Meredith and his team have had to work really hard over the last couple of days to knock this track back into shape for tonight's meeting. In the middle of the first and second corner, dirtometer out, let's take a closer look. Actually, pretty firm down here. And I must say, they've obviously tar-packed that pretty hard. What's different about this evening's track from when we were previously here? No man's land in the middle of the track. There is grip. As a consequence of the weather that they have had and the racing they had on Saturday with the flat track Grand Prix, there's quite a lot of grip here. And I think that will change bike setups for riders when they inspect the track. I'm sure that they will then relay that to their mechanics. Up high on the banking, as always, they've ripped it up. Dirtometer going in a fair amount, so plenty of grip out here. I'm sure we're going to see some spectacular action here as the evening goes on. Of course, the big news, Ty Woofenden is in the Sheffield Tigers team, which is smashing to see him back in British Speedway. Sheffield have had a bit of a hoodoo over the champions, the Aces, this year, and I suspect that the home team will be very fired up tonight to try and get their revenge with the War of the Roses back on tonight. Should be a cracker.
Let's hope so. Well, there is loads of speedway going on around the country, but we've sent our cameras and Dave Rowe to Peterborough as they host Ipswich. Dave Rowe?
Well, it has been an extraordinary week of rider movement in the Premiership, and the headline move, Chris Harris leaving Leicester and rejoining Peterborough as number one and captain. Harris takes the place of Richie Warrigg, who's part of a double change at Leicester, with Craig Cook also coming in. The Lions race at Wolverhampton tonight, but here at the Showground, Harris is back in the side to face Ipswich, and they are a team who are really gaining ground. We saw the Witches win at Leicester last week. They then won 50-40 at King's Lynn on Thursday. A win tonight could take them into the top four, depending on the Sheffield result, but they have raced more matches than the other contenders. So Harris is number one for the Panthers. The lineup is reshuffled with Niels Krishnevason moving to number five. There's no Vadim Tarasenko tonight. He's done a great job since coming in, but he misses this meeting for family reasons. It's rider replacement at number two, with Ben Cook and the two reserves taking the rides. Ipswich simply have to keep winning. They did win here way back on opening night when Nicky Pedersen crashed out. So much strength in Saifudinov and Doyle, but it's also been a good run for captain Danny King, and he has plenty of track knowledge here. Witches lead by 18 on aggregate, but they need all three league points here at the East of England Arena. It's Peterborough against Ipswich.
There is a great crowd in here tonight, including the Yorkshire Barmy Army. Let's see what reception they give for Ty Woofenden. It is time for the Riders' Parade. Your commentator, Calvin Tatum.
Thanks very much, Abby. Thoroughly looking forward to this. We've got a glorious evening. And a healthy crowd in here in the National Speedway Stadium. We'll take a look at the Sheffield Tigers first up. Young Dan Gills coming out on track, the rising star for the Sheffield Tigers, involved in the Speedway of Nations 2 final in Riga at the weekend as well. Louis Kerr coming back from injury, his first meeting since that broken collarbone. So he's a little nervous, but keen to get on with the action once again. And of course, the man of the moment, my man to watch tonight for the Sheffield Tigers, Ty Woofenden, back in British Speedway. Fabulous news. Had a little bit of a drama before the meeting with his both bikes not running, but pleased to say that that is all sorted out now, and he is now up and running. Josh Pickering, of course, a fairly recent signing for the Sheffield Tigers. Coming out, the Australian rider, hard-charging Australian rider. no doubt that he always comes up with some entertaining performances. Adam Ellis coming out, the number three rider for the Sheffield Tigers. No question that on his night, Adam can be quite a star performer. A little up and down this year in the UK, but no doubt Adam played his part in the Speedway World Cup final, of course, last week. Carl Howarth, the captain, a hard charger into number two. Obviously, he has been down at reserve, but Louis Kerr is in reserve, but Carl Howarth riding at number two tonight, the captain of the Tigers. And as a consequence of Ty Woofenden coming in, Tobias Michelak goes in at number one, and another fine rider. Certainly has been a terrific servant for the Sheffield Tigers. So there is the visiting team. We focus on the home team. Connor Bailey is the rising star for the Bellevue Aces, the champions, of course. Looking for a big night tonight. Connor Bailey going along quite nicely. Norik Vladorn, of course, the German, has ridden here now for two or three seasons. The German champion last year, senior German champion, only still a teenager, so a rider certainly on the up and up. Dan Bewley now, going to be quite a matchup. He's my man to watch as well for the Bellevue Aces. Going to be an interesting matchup between Dan Bewley and Ty Woofenden, teammates, of course, in Wrocław in the Ekstraliga in Poland, and racing against each other tonight. So could be quite a battle between the two. Next man out, former British champion, of course, is Charles Wright. Another really forceful rider and an entertaining rider to watch, a fan favourite through and through. Charles, no doubt about it. A lot of these guys haven't been racing too much lately with all the rain-offs around. So keen to get back to action. Jamin Lidsey, the young Australian, has been riding superbly well this season. So he will be looking to get back to winning ways tonight. That's for sure. Tom Brennan, of course, part of the Speedway World Cup last Saturday in Wrocław. Tom certainly back into the main body of the team now, having spent some time at reserve, so looking to get off to a fast start tonight. And Brady Kurtz now moves to number one as Dan Bewley drops down to number five. And Brady Kurtz is having a smashing season for the Bellevue Aces, really leading from the front, and he'll be out in the opening race tonight. So there are the two teams for you this evening, a smashing crowd in, and we'll get back down to Ebbie now.
So the hashtag tonight is Belshi. I've got a feeling that social media might be quite busy. What do you think about three-time world champion being back on UK shale? So here in Manchester, it's Bellevue versus Sheffield, two superstars in Dan Bewley versus Ty Woofenden, and it's not next. Major headlines in the UK, in the world of Speedway. Ty, there's so much pressure, but when you're a three-time world champion and you, look, you bring a star quality to this sport, it is so important. How does it feel to be back here?
Yeah, it's really good. Obviously, when we was in Wrocław, Jack got injured, and then Steady, I think he just said it like jokingly, like, oh, do you want to fill in for Jack for 28 days? And I went, yeah, why not? And that was it. That was a done deal. So I'm really excited, looking forward to it. I think the last time I rode in England was when I was with Wolves, which wasn't that long ago, maybe 2016. And then obviously racing for Sheffield. The last time I rode around Sheffield, I think, would have been 2008. So it's, it's just something different. I'm looking forward to it. And hopefully I can do a good job for the team and see what happens when Jack's back.
But 7 years without riding here on UK shale, obviously with Speedway of Nations and those things with GB, different story. But to have it done so simply with just a quick phone call is just, it's unbelievable.
Oh, we're Speedway riders, we're not footballers, so everything's easy.
But why couldn't that phone call have happened, you know, 5 years ago, 4 years ago? Why has it taken so long?
Probably like my decision, really. Like, I've been so focused on the World Championships and doing Poland and Sweden and being at that super high level all the time. But a lot of the boys have been saying like super positive things. Like there was years ago, you know, you talk to the guys in the airport and there'd be a lot of negativity around, and it was like, okay, I'll just steer clear of that. And for the last probably like year and a half, 2 years, whenever I've spoke to the boys, everyone's been super like supportive of the league and how everything's been going and the tracks and all that sort of stuff. And you know, it's great. You got Dan, Emil, Artem, who else? We got JMO's here. Who else is riding in the league?
Doily, yeah, Max Frick. Yeah. Loads of the Speedway Grand Prix guys.
It's stacked. So it's super fun to come back. Obviously, moved back to the UK this year. So, you know, it's the same country I'm living in. And I feel like it makes sense. So probably maybe next year, if it's still a top league and it's not one league, then hopefully there's a club out there that would like to sign me.
I'm pretty sure there is. I was about to say, I didn't want to get ahead of ourselves, but is this laying down a bit of a foundation for what could be a full season here next year?
I haven't really given it too much thought, honestly. Like I said before, there's lots of positives going. I'm living in England, living in England again, which is amazing. And, you know, Faye and the kids are super happy. And yeah, it's just maybe it's time for a change. I've been doing that for a long time, and my performances at World Championship level haven't been where I want them to be. So have a little change and mix things up a bit. I already noticed just like being in here, there's like no pressure. Like you're walking around the pits, everyone's talking, everyone's happy, everyone's smiling. And it's just like, it's a nice vibe. Yeah,
there is, there's a good spirit. And your bikes arrived this morning.
Yeah, so these are the two bikes. I have five bikes in Poland, and we rotate them all season to keep everything fresh. I bought a new van this year, so my old van was just kind of sat there for, well, my mate came over from Australia to do the 250 championship. So he used my bike. He used these two bikes and my old van, and then he left on the Sunday after the World Cup. And then obviously I spoke to Steady, and it was like, right, get the bikes set up for a 500, because obviously a little bit different with the 250s. Boys loaded them up, and yeah, they arrived this morning. I drove to Steady's, and we got the van loaded up, got all the toolbox set up. Tank Tool sent me out a nice toolbox with all the gear. So it was like Christmas this morning, and now I get to go have fun and race my bike.
It's a job done. It's great to see you back.
Thanks. Good to be back.
Welcome back to Manchester and the Sports Insure Premiership, where Bellevue Aces host Sheffield Tigers. But before we get underway with the action, a reminder of the other motorsport coming up across the channel includes British Superbikes round 7 there in Thruxton. That'll be Saturday at 1 o'clock, Eurosport 2. Speedway Grand Prix Series, we're in Riga in Latvia, a new venue, and coverage starts 2:30 p.m. on Discovery Plus. And then the Motocross World Championships are in Sweden, also Discovery Plus, and that's Sunday at midday. But here at the National Speedway Stadium, it is time for Heat 1, and over to you, Kelvin.
Thank you very much, Abby. Just to bring you the information that Bellevue won the coin toss for the gate positions and elected to go with Heat 15. And Carl Howarth decided that he wanted his team to go from gates 1 and 3 in the opening race. Big meeting this. Bellevue, champions, have found it tough against the Sheffield Tigers this year. Sheffield won home and away against them in the first fixture, in the A fixture. They beat Bellevue just recently by 10 points. So on aggregate, which is up for grabs as well this evening, Bellevue Aces have got to claw that back as well. So they need to win by more than 10 to pick up all 3 points on offer. Interesting to keep an eye on that as the evening develops. Brady Kurtz out in the first race, not used to that, so he's coming out for the opening race of the night. And Kurtz has been in terrific form for the Bellevue Aces this year, no question about that. Tom Brennan also out in the first race as well, so a new pairing there. It's interesting to see how they gel this evening. Tobias Musilak and Carl Howarth, a pretty strong pairing from the visitors as well, so should be quite an entertaining opening race of the evening. As I say, 1-3 for the visitors. There was no hesitation from Carl Howarth. But these two, of course, slugged it out, of course, in the grand final last year with the Bellevue Aces coming out on top. It was a real grandstand finish. Gate number one, Carl Howarth go from the inside in the yellow helmet colour. Gate number two is Tom Brennan in blue. Tomasz Michalak will come out of gate number three in white, and Brady Kurtz off the outside in red. Track possibly is grippier than normal. Had a flat track Grand Prix here on Saturday when it rained throughout the day. I think we all know how much it rained on Saturday. It was quite biblical, the weather. Fortunately this evening we've got a fine evening and the sun is out. but there is a bit more grip out there. Be interesting to see how the riders adapt. Light setup could be slightly different this evening. Green lights on for the opening race of the evening. Underway. Desperate there for Tom Brennan. Like it's just given up the ghost on the start line, but out in front. Terrific stuff there. And Michalak has hit the front. Brady Kurtz now coming through into second place with Carl Howard back in third place. Brady Kurtz coming on really strongly there, but Tobias Michalak has made a smashing start away from gate number three. He's powering away out in front. Kurtz back in second place. There's no doubt that having to hold it tight in first one. Carl Howard giving chase in second place, but this is a terrific start for the visitors. A 4-2 on the cards right from the get-go here this evening. Michalak coming under a little pressure, but I don't think Brady Kurtz is prepared to move out wide at this stage. And Michalak, when he hits the front, is a fine rider. Looking good, down the back straight for the final time in the opening race. Michalak from Poland doing the business. Out of the last corner, wins in style. Visitors get off to a good start, strong start from them, a 4-2. Brady Kurtz tried hard in second place, but just couldn't manage to land a blow. Carl Howarth, the misery, of course, for Tom Brennan with the bike, literally just gave up the ghost as soon as he dropped the clutch when he went away from the tapes. So bitterly disappointing for him, but Michalak out in front, 3 points for him. Brady Kurtz, 2 points for the aces, 1 point for Carl Howarth in third, and no points for Tom Brennan with that mechanical issue in the opening race. And Scott, I've got to say that was a nice ride from Michalak, and he's a handy performer, and as hard as Kurtz tried, he just couldn't land a glove on it in the first race.
No, he certainly is, Kel. Michalak, we know how fast he can be. We've seen him at Sheffield and obviously shown his dominance here. We're focused here on Tom Brennan. Like you said, there's a big let. Oh, you can see the rear chain snap there. That's totally let go. That's an unfortunate start for Tom Brennan to see the bikes react. Look at that chain whip around. He's lucky that didn't actually catch the back of his leg, because that would have stung. But we'll focus on Michalak here in white off gate three. Gets a run on Brady Kurtz there. It's a long, long way from the outside. Brady managed just to get the legs on Kyle Howarth there. Kelvin down the back straight. And not quite enough for the aces, but a 4-2 for the Sheffield Tigers. A good start for them.
Yeah, I wonder whether Brady Kurtz may have attempted to ride a little bit wider there, maybe just chance his arm, but clearly he didn't. I wonder why that was.
Yeah, possibly so, but it's early doors, Kelvin, like you did on your track prep. They've ripped the track a little bit lower down, so that roost would have probably been pretty heavy. So, but as we focus on that man there, my teammate Oxford Louis Kerr coming back first race from that injury.
Yeah, good point, actually. Louis Kerr back in the sport after a broken collarbone. That we were there, we actually witnessed it. And Louis Kerr could be quite a useful reserve as a switch around with Carl Howarth was reserved previously. Fine job for the Sheffield Tigers. Was transferred across from the Kings Lynn Stars last year and has done very well since he's joined the club. Connor Bailey is the rising star for the home team. We're on board with him this evening. Hoping to get some good shots from him throughout. Connor, who said he's been a bit frustrated lately, had a good chat with him actually before the meeting started, and just said he's had four rain-offs in the last week. Kyle Howarth was actually saying to me he's had 16 rain-offs in total. It just shows you how tough the weather's been. So plenty of racing to come this year. There's no doubt that teams will have to catch up. 4 points to two to the Tigers. Ty Wolfenden there just waiting patiently for his first ride tonight, which will be heat number four. But heat number two, riders are up at tapes, just preparing themselves, a bit of gardening going on. Line up for heat number two is Norbert Bledorn for the home team in red on the inside gate. Louis Kerr out of gate number two in white. Connor Bailey from gate number three in blue, and off the outside gate is Dan Giltz in yellow. And we'll say Louis Kerr has been terrific for the Sheffield Tigers, and if he can just get away here and settle down and get his confidence up, he could be a very useful performer indeed. He can lower the colours of anybody when he's really on fire. Maybe just feeling that arm. It's only been 4 weeks since he broke that collarbone. Heat two, green light comes on, gates up, we're underway. Kurtz made a smashing start from gate two. He fires himself to the front, round the outside in the blue helmet colour. There's Connor Bailey down the back straight, and Bailey's done a fine job there, getting the better of And Louis Kerr, Nori Vlador trying to force his way through as well. But Conor Bailey, that was a really nice move on the opening lap there. Got a lot of speed. And look at him go out in front. He's stretching away. Smashing ride from the young rising star there. Busy man rides all over Europe as well as three teams in the UK as well. Settling down now. Conor Bailey out in front, doing a good job for the home team. And the home team responding here with a potential 4-2 on the cards as well. Vlador back in third place, just running a little bit wider in turns three and four, trying to find a bit of extra speed, but no doubt about this one. Conor Bailey out in front has got this all tied up. Down the back straight for the last time. It's moving further and further away. Very impressive ride from the youngster out in heat number two. Kerr's going to hang on to second place with Vlador trying awfully hard, trying to get round the outside there. Dan Gilks just missing out in the opening ride for the reserve riders, but for Conor Bailey, we were on board with him, but we didn't see any riders because he was flying out in front. Fair play to him. That squares it all up. 6 points apiece after two rides this evening. So Conor Bailey, it's a celebratory lap there. The home crowd delighted with that. Smashing move, in truth, out of that first corner. So the result of heat number two, Conor Bailey out in front, 3 points for him. Louis Kerr back in the sport, 2 points for him. Laurent Vlador back in one point in third place, and Dan Gilks misses out. Tell you what, Scott, that was a very impressive ride there from Conor Bailey.
It certainly was, Kelf. See Dan Gilks off the outside gate, doesn't quite get the jump. We're on board with Conor Bailey. Sometimes the on board's a curse, but it was no such thing for Conor Bailey. Obviously high on confidence after winning that British under 21. Swoops around the outside of Louis Kerr, though you can see from the inside here. Louis Kerr in the white, he actually makes a start there, holds down low, but Conor Bailey uses that grip that you highlighted in your track piece, Kelf, mid-track. And I have to say, I think, to me, Kelf, Louis Kerr looks a little bit tentative there. I think he'll be much more settled now after that first race, but coming back off that broken collarbone, you see him have a little look there. I think the nerves may have been there just early doors.
Yeah, that's understandable, isn't it, Scott, you know, when you've had a month out?
Yeah, it certainly is, especially with a fast-paced track like Bellevue, and with that little bit of extra dirt pad on there, like you said, all that rain and doing all that track prep on there, it's going to be hard on the body, hard on the shoulder. So understandably, Louis is probably a little bit reserved there. But back to you, Kel. Here we go, heat three.
Number three. Louis Kerr will be feeling much better. Now he's got four laps under his belt. But there's no doubt that the home team bounced back. And we're 6 points apiece with riders coming out for heat number three. Jarmin Lidsey's out here. He's done very well for Team Australia as well as the Bellevue Aces this year. Adam Ellis did a fine job also for Team Great Britain, who came so very close to winning the Speedway World Cup final. Will they be able to win the War of the Roses here tonight, the Sheffield Tigers? There's plenty of rivalry, of course, between these two teams. Charles Wright out here as well. So another super lineup for the heat number three. No question about that. Line up then for heat number three. Ty Wolfenden with Simon Stead just keenly looking on. He'll be probably a little nervous to get his first ride under his belt here this evening. Line up then for heat number three is Adam Ellis off the inside in white. Charles Wright out of gate number two in blue. Josh Pickering off the gate number three in yellow, and Jarmin Lidsey off the outside in red. Josh Pickering, of course, signed in the mid-season for the Sheffield Tigers, coming away from the Kingsland Stars. Can be a real hard charger. I had a nasty shoulder injury earlier this year, but says he's back to full fitness now. Whoa, bit of movement on the outside there from Lindsay. Red lights are on. Craig Aykroyd, the referee, has no hesitation. He actually did penalise himself there, so he may have been able to let that go, Craig, but decides that it was unsatisfactory and he wants to have all four riders back. Side on view will give us a clear picture of exactly what went on here. The rider on the outside, I believe, is the one that moves. There you can clearly see it. But he did actually miss the start as a consequence. But all riders will come back to the tapes for a second time. There you can hear it. The 2 minute siren is on. So riders have got just under that to make their way back round to the tapes. It's 1 minute, although the clock in front of me is saying two, but Phil Morris in charge down there is just making sure that the riders are more than aware they've only got 60, well, they've got less than 60 seconds now to get themselves back to tapes. Brady Kurtz just having a chat with Jamin Lidsey there. So riders now getting a hurry up from Phil Morris, who's in charge, a little bit like the similar role that he plays at the Grand Prix, Phil. Been involved in British Speedway, started at the beginning of the season and beginning to make his impact. So this is an important meeting with for Bellevue. They're in fourth place, but Ipswich are on a bit of a roll right now. They're racing this evening. We'll bring you updates about the Peterborough match as well. But although the Ipswich Witches have raced significantly more meetings, there's no doubt they've found some form. And any comfort zone that the Bellevue Aces had has vanished. So although they've got meetings in hand, they cannot relax and they'll need to get the points on the board if they don't want to slip up. Line up once again for the restaging of heat number three is Ellis on the inside, Charles Wright out of gate two, Pickering out of gate three, and Lidsey off the outside. Here we go. They all behave themselves. We're underway. Certainly tightening into the first corner. Lidsey done nicely round the outside, got the better of Pickering there. Charles Wright coming through in the third place with Adam Ellis out the back. Super first corner from Jamin Lidsey. He really just sat back on the bike and dug in, charged the front. We saw that with Bailey in the previous race. Josh Pickering there coming under pressure from Charles Wright. Charles Wright trying to work his bike hard, really keeping Josh Pickering honest. Pickering now, Ellis has moved wide. Jamin Lidsey pulling further and further away. Charles Wright do anything about Josh Pickering back in second place? No, just locked the bike there and killed his momentum, gives Josh Pickering a little bit of breathing space there into second place. Wright has gone wide, will that give an opportunity for Ellis up the inside? Lidsey, meanwhile though, is looking majestic out in front. Mid-grip, there's a lot of grip, mid-track, excuse me. No doubt about that, was pulling his arms off there, no doubt about that. Smashing ride from Lidsey. He wins nicely, comfortably in the end. Pickering doing a good job for the Tigers, back in second place. Charles Wright there just hanging on in third, but that man in fine form right now for the Bellevue Aces, doing a really good job. He has developed this season, no question about it, the 24-year-old Australian rider. He wins heat number one then, Jamin Lidsey, 3 points for him. Josh Pickering back in second place, 2 points. Charles Wright, 1 point for the Bellevue Aces, and Adam Ellis misses out in heat number three. Scotty, another smashing ride from Jamin Lidsey here. He really does make that bike work around the first turn.
Certainly does. He takes advantage of the fact he's just almost level with Josh Pickering there and yellow off gate three. Takes advantage of the fact that he's on that dirt line that you just talked about during the race, Kelvin. Also, from there on, he just settled into the race, kept his wheels in line, let the bike flow, wasn't kind of restricting the bike. You see here, he's got a nice style, leaning back, letting the bike do all the work. You see the boys behind, they then started to kind of jostle with each other. And you know this track, Kelvin, it's if you start trying to ride defensive like the boys at the back did, you really scrub your speed and it allows Jamin to stretch out and just create an even bigger lead out front.
Yeah, good looking rider, Jamin Lidsey, there's no question about that. And a rider that has a bright future, I would suggest. Now, heat number four, Ty Woffenden back in British Speedway. A fine sight indeed. There he is, making his first appearance since 2016 in the Premiership. So we are delighted that the three-time former world champion is back. Had a bit of a drama, though. I can bring it to you now. Bikes were delivered, neither of them started, so there was a little bit of a panic, but fortunately, all is well now. And he is making his way round to the start. And it is a terrific clash here in heat number four. Dan Bewley, of course, for the home team. They ride together in Wrocław in the Extra Liga, but they're going head-to-head here this evening. Dan Bewley there just having a last-minute check to his rear chain. And Stevie Lawson there working alongside him, just taking a little bit of slack out of the chain. But Dan Bewley slipping down to number five, was number one for a while. His form has been a touch in and out for the Bellevue Aces, but he'll want to put on a fine show here this evening, no question about that. But I'm thoroughly looking forward to it. We have under 60 seconds now for Dan to make his way round to the start. Dan, of course, rode superbly well, won the last Grand Prix in Melilla. That was a terrific effort. But this man, as I say, he has been the talk of the town leading up to tonight with his move back into British Speedway. Simon Stead made that contact, of course, and made the call. Gate number four, Dan Gilkes off the inside in the yellow helmet colour. Gate number two in blue is Connor Bailey. Ty Wolfenden out of gate number three in white. And Dan Bewley off the outside in red. Two big hitters off the outside gates here. Connor Bailey very impressive in heat number two, so you can't rule him out either. British Speedway, get a bit of confidence, and he pops out here. Could be kind of tussle in that first corner. Heat four, away we go. Wolfenden's made a fabulous start off of gate number three. Absolutely nailed it. Bewley coming through round the outside of Connor Bailey down the back straight for the first time. Here we go then, former three-time world champion out in front. What a start it was. Absolutely electric reactions off the tapes. Firing away out in front. Knows this place well, of course, because he's ridden here in the Speedway of Nations. But Bewley now beginning to give chase. Two Grand Prix stars out in front. Bewley beginning to wind it up. Nothing to choose between the two. Wolfenden coming under more pressure. Bewley beginning to speed it up. Two Grand Prix stars going head to head here in heat number four. Now Wolfenden having to ride with the eyes in the back of his head here. But Bewley is lurking there. Bailey back in third and Gilkes out the back. But Wolfenden down the back straight for the final time on his return to the sport. Now Bewley coming up the inside. Going to get tight. Oh! Wolfenden just about held on there. What an opening showdown that was. And Wolfenden back in British Speedway wins this first race. It's a 3-all. Superb race as well. Just ran a little wide there, opened the door up for Bewley, but he just hangs on. So a little bit of a scare there for Ty at the end of his opening race. No doubt about that, but Simon Stead, a touch relieved to see his new signing win his first race of the evening. So there we go. That's what it's all about. Hits the ground running, Ty Wolfenden. So the result, Ty Wolfenden, 3 points for him. Dan Bewley back in second place, 2 points. Connor Bailey picks up a point for third place. And Dan Gilkes misses out in heat number four. So a shared race. It's 13 points for the Aces, 11 points for Tigers. But Scotty, I tell you what, Ty had to hang on there in the end.
He certainly did. He's three-time world champion. He's not short of confidence, but he would have definitely been feeling a few nerves at the start of the line there, Kel. But he comes under a lot of pressure from Dan Bewley. Kind of have to wonder if those little bike gremlins at the start had a little bit of an impact. But it's important for Ty there to get the race win for the Sheffield Tigers and for him himself. But Dan Bewley, like you said, he put him under pressure for the whole race. Dan slips down to number five, but he knows his place inside out, exceptionally fast, and it all come down to that last lap, last bend, and a race to the finish line. But Ty managed to do enough. He'll take some confidence from that. Look forward to his next few races and see how it pans out. But in the meantime, I think we're going to have a little break now and throw down to Abby.
A high-pressure moment for Ty Wolfenden. You've heard Calvin say as well moments before we went on air, having big drama with his bikes. But he gets a win under his belt. Get onto that social media platform, your one of choice, and use the hashtag Belshi. And then after the break, we'll get the latest from Peterborough Ipswich. We are joined by Sheffield Tigers team boss, Simon Stead. Steady, this is huge for the club, but also for the sport of Speedway in this country to have a three-time world champion back here on British Isle. How did this come about?
Well, obviously, first and foremost, we lost Jack at the World Cup, which was really disappointing for us as a club. He was riding really well, probably the best I've ever seen him riding. So we were obviously disappointed to lose Jack, but it became evident very, very quickly that we were going to need some sort of replacement due to fixture congestion at the end of the season, lots of rain-offs, and a really important month for us. So it was an easy phone call, if I'm honest, Abby. Identified that you know, Wolfie was obviously fell within the remits of the averages. So It was a bit of a no-brainer. Phoned him, asked him if he was up for it. He asked me to send him the fixtures, which I did straight away. He came back and said, yeah, let's make it happen. So like that, it happened. We obviously had to move quite quickly because we wanted him in as soon as we could, and we had to make arrangements for his equipment and what have you to get over here. But the actual process was pretty easy. Ty was super accommodating, and he wanted to be back in British Speedway. So, yeah, it was great.
It's an extraordinary move that sounds so simple when you think it's been 7 years since we've seen him racing here. But like you said, first and foremost, Jack Holder. So just a word on Jack. He's undergone an operation, hasn't he, for his wrist. Will he be back this season?
Well, that's our hope. We obviously want Jack back. He's been absolutely superb for us this year. So it was really unfortunate, a nasty injury. But he's in good hands. He's been to his hospital in Lublin, where he races in Poland, and he's seen the very best of surgeons. So he's been in good hands. He's been well taken care of and given the best chance possible, because not only do we want him back for Sheffield, but obviously he was fighting right up there at the top of the GP standings as well. So he's got lots to fight for. So hopefully he'll be back sooner rather than later.
Yeah, we wish Jack Holder well, but Ty Woofen, and it's exciting. We want this kind of buzz about the sport in this place, and he certainly brings that star quality. He obviously knows Bellevue well, but what will it be like on Thursday on Sheffield? I think it's been 14 or 15 years, hasn't he, since he's raced around there?
Yeah, I think when you're somebody that's as world-class as Ty is, you don't forget how to do it. So I've got no reservations, or had no reservations whatsoever about bringing him over. I was just over the moon that things just sort of fell into place. You know, sometimes it's just right place, right time, an opportunity that worked for both the club and Ty. So over the moon that we made it happen. And excited about the buzz that's around the place, because obviously it is an important part of the season, and we need to continue our good form. We were unbeaten in July, so we need to keep that going.
And really important for the playoffs at the moment. You and Ipswich are equal on points, but you've got 5 matches in hand for Ipswich. But it's important, isn't it? It's a business end of the season.
Yeah, that's right. You can't take that for granted. We've seen just over the last week or so that Ipswich have been really, really dominant. They've had some good away wins, so we can't take our foot off the gas. And that was, you know, a reason why we needed to bring in. I didn't feel like rider replacement or guest facility was adequate to cover Jack's position. So. Yeah, like I said, delighted that we've got Ty in, and I know he's super pumped for tonight as well.
Thanks, Teddy.
Thank you.
Well, that does look like the track prep is complete by our track staff. So we'll get the lineup out for heat to number 5, sponsored by Mile Band. Riding in.
Welcome back to the National Speedway Stadium here in Manchester. Bellevue host Sheffield Tigers. 2 superstars in action tonight in Dan Bewley and Ty Woofen. So you imagine the scoreline to be close. It is 13-11 and 53-61 on aggregate. Let's head to the East of England Arena now and get the latest from Dave Rowe.
Was a big night for the Ipswich, which is trying to chase down the top 4. Massive meeting for them at the East of England Showground, and they've got off to a perfect start in Heat 1, because Emil Saifudinov in white making it around the outside. What a start by Eric Riss in yellow. It's a really tough season so far for the Witches, all sorts of injury and illness issues, but Eric Riss and Emil Saifudinov off to a 5-1 start there for the visitors, and Chris Harris in red unable to make any way through. Jordan Jenkins was taking the rider replacement ride. Heat 2 and Ipswich in good gating form once again, with Daniel Hume in white round the outside in red. Patrick Podewo, the recent signing, almost getting it completely wrong on the back straight, but just about holding off Dan Thompson, the rider in yellow. Flying start for the meeting for the Witches, and Thompson having a great run in recent weeks. He did well in the under 21 British final recently. He's been piling up points for Leicester in the National Development League, really doing well since joining Ipswich. We saw him last week, of course, starring on his former circuit. This time couldn't quite make it through into second place, but still a handy 4-2 there for the Witches in Heat 2. However, things then began to turn, because Peterborough hit back in Heat 3. Benjamin Basso and Ben Cook, a really important engine room combination for the Panthers, squeezing out Danny King there off the second turn. Basel and Cook racing clear on the first lap, and King unable to make any way through with Keenan Rue at the back. So Panthers getting back into contention with that 5-1 in race number three, making it to 8-10 after three races. Basso and Cook with the 5-1. And then what about this in heat four? Nils Christian Iversen in red, Patrick Badewu in blue. They make a flying start. It's Jason Doyle in white, who has not made a good start, finding himself out the back. And that's a huge surprise in heat four. Badewu holding the inside line with Iversen going around the outside, and no way through for Jason Doyle. Big 5-1 there for the Panthers. Jason Doyle eclipsed by Badewu and Iversen, and four heats gone. Peterborough 13, Ipswich 11.
13-11 in Peterborough, 13-11 here in Manchester. It is time for heat five. And to you, Calvin Tatum.
Thank you very much, Abby. Some tight matches going on this evening. Delighted that we can bring you matches, because as I say, the weather has been really clement recently and it's been tough to get meetings on, rain offs everywhere. So great to be on this evening, on a Monday evening. Just the 2 points between these two teams. Hotly contested match in the first four races, no doubt about that. Very little to choose between the two teams. I expect that to continue. Bellevue will be pressured tonight, there's no doubt about that, with Sheffield Tigers clearly very determined to get some more points on the board. So riders approaching tapes for the resumption of racing. Second time out for all four now, of course. They're into the second block of races. Jaimin Lidzi out here again. He's a handy rider, won his first ride. Mark Lemon looking pretty relaxed there. But there's no doubt as the meeting goes on, if it stays this tight, I suspect, but both team managers will be a little tense, that's for sure. Aggregate point up for grabs as well. Line-up heat number five. Jaimin Lidzi off the inside in red. Carl Howarth off the gate number two position in yellow. Charles Wright out of gate number three in blue. And Tobias Musialak, a fine ride first time out, off the outside in white. Can he make it from there? Charles Wright can be a tough customer. They're coming away from gate number three, so could be quite a elbow banging going towards the first turn. Carl Howarth picked up a nice handy point in his first ride as well. Beginning to settle down. Ron Shaw, the start marshal, just calling riders forward now. Craig Aykroyd is our referee. And he's the man with his finger on the button. Well, Mushnak just coming forward now. So here we are. Meet number five. Takes up. Away we go. Charles Wright has made a decent start, but Lidzi on the inside. What a move from Musialak there. Cut back beautifully to come out in the second place, but Howarth there. Tigers in second and third, with Charles Wright stuck at the back. Lidzi once again showing great speed out in front, made that inside gate work a treat. Musialak, oh, Wright's gone down at the back. Heavy fall for him, awkward. Can he get the bike off the track? Yes, he is. Race is going to continue, looking like a thrill with Lidzi out in front, going great guns. I'll tell you what, there's some grip out there. He's putting his arms off. Musialak now coming through into second place with Carl Howarth settling for third. Not going to be anything here, it's going to be a shared race, but Lidzi's shown great form tonight, won his first race in fine style. Going to do exactly the same in his second one. Look at him go, going further and further away. I tell you what, that bike is absolutely singing out there tonight. No question about that. Smashing ride from him. 3 points in the bag, shared race with Charles Wright just coming a cropper there, coming out of turn two. Don't know if there was a problem with the bike that caused that. May well have been. Didn't quite catch it out of the corner of my eye. We'll bring you some more news on that if at all possible. But that man, two rides and two wins. Jaimin Lidzi out in front, 3 points for him. Tobias Musialak coming through into second place, 2 points. Carl Howarth, 1 point for the Sheffield Tigers, and Charles Wright, of course, with the mechanical issue midway through the race. And Scotty, I don't quite know what happened to Charles Wright, but a smashing ride once again from Lidzi, who is in top form.
Oh, he certainly is. A bit uncharacteristic from Charles, I have to say there. And a few of the boys are saying that gate one wasn't working too good. So I was keen to look at that. And Jaimin Lidzi just poo-pooed that one for us all. So just showed his dominance out front. And like I say, once he gets going, he just keeps his wheels in line. He's very calm on the bike and just stretches away. Musialak there in second is giving chase. And I think this is where Charles Wright makes his mistake. I'm not sure if we get it just out of shot here. I think it might be, yeah, he just gets grip. And I think the back end just loses Kelvin. He just slips out and does well to get up, to be fair.
Yeah, I wondered whether there'd been, sometimes you see a chain, but the back tire's just let go on him, hasn't it?
Yeah, he's just caught a little bit of that grip mid-turn. Like I say, it's probably a little bit more grip down in the middle of the track than normal, and obviously when he's come from that, he's gone across onto the slick stuff, the back wheel's let go, and he's gone down. And obviously this man here, Tom Brennan, chain, false link actually snapped in the first race, so he'll be a little bit apprehensive at that start line. Hope the same thing doesn't happen.
Yes, he'll be keeping his fingers crossed. Tom Brennan just doing a practice start and going back to see his mechanic while Ty Woofenden comes around for his second ride. He's got that inside gate, so he'll be encouraged by the fact that Jamin Lidsey made a really good start. Extra precaution here for Tom Brennan. Quite unsettling when that happens on the start line. But he's making his way round now, so he's will have no problems at all. Louis Kerr out as well. So much interest with Ty Woofenden coming back into the sport. Really is great tonight, and a really good crowd in here in the National Speedway Stadium. And largely, I would suggest, because that man is back on our shores and racing. Got off to a winning start under a bit of pressure from Dan Bewley. Maybe have just made a few tweaks to the setup for his second ride here. Just seemed to lack a little bit of speed with Bewley winding it up in second place. See how he gets on this time after a hard charge in Brady Kurtz. Inside gate then is Ty Woofenden with the white helmet colour. Brady Kurtz out of gate number two in red. Louis Kerr from gate number three in yellow. And Tom Brennan off the outside in blue, looking for his first points of the evening. Looking for his first laps of the evening as well, because the bike didn't go anywhere at all. Looking to bounce back this time. Brady Kurtz, as I said earlier on, has been in terrific form for the Bellevue Aces. The Australian rider has been certainly having great guns and developing as a top line rider. Here we go. Heat number six underway. Woofenden's made a really good start on the inside. Louis Kerr there alongside it, and the Tigers are taking it to the Aces here. Woofenden doing a smashing job of team riding, keeping an eye on where Kerr was. Looked over his shoulder at least twice down the back straight. He's allowed his partner around. Tigers dominating heat number six here. Once again, Kerr clearly feeling a lot better after his first ride in heat number two, winding it on. Brady Kerr's now setting about the Sheffield Tigers, but they're riding well as a pair. Midway through the race then, Woofenden having made a super start off the inside and helping his teammate, just dropping back from Kerr there, just hit a couple of slick patches in turns one and two. Kurtz coming on stronger the longer the race goes on. Tom Brennan there round the inside as well, but the Tigers have got this one all wrapped up, and they really are putting the home team now under a big pressure. Huge result here for heat number six. Tigers pick up a 5-1. Brilliant stuff. Woofenden making his presence felt here, no question about it, and helping Louis Kerr. We'll watch that again with Scotty afterwards. That was terrific team riding as well from Woofenden, aware that his teammate was with him. And they pick up a maximum score as a consequence, and as hard as Brady Kurtz tried in third place, the Sheffield Tigers were able to dominate heat number six, no question about that. So Brady Kurtz actually slipping back to fourth place actually in the end. Very close indeed. And they were all a bit shaky like that. Okay, it is Brady Kurtz that just held on. So in the context of the meeting though, it's 1 point to the Bellevue Aces, irrespective of who scored it. Louis Kerr out in front. Really good ride that from him. Ty Woofenden unbeaten by an opponent so far. 2 points for him. Brady Kurtz did hang on to third place. 1 point. Tom Brennan misses out for the second time this evening. And Scotty, not only did Ty Woofenden make the start there, that was a brilliant bit of awareness when he went down the back straight as well.
Oh, fantastic, Kelby. You see him have a look going into the first turn. Louis Kerr almost has a bit too wide. Another look. I mean, it's great. Three looks down the back straight. He knows what to do. He can't show off too much, Kelby, because you know how important it is to keep the momentum up here. But he just lets Louis Kerr go around the outside. Look at that. Three big looks down that back straight. Bellevue's so wide, he doesn't have to deviate from his line. Let's Louis come around the outside. Louis obviously was feeling a little bit nervous in that first race, but what a result there. Fantastic. Big 5-1 for the Sheffield Tigers. Abby, I believe you've got a man that's going to mean a lot too.
Yeah, I'm sure it does. To steady two big heats for Ty Woffenden, and under that sort of pressure, especially what he was experiencing with his bikes moment before we started this meeting.
Yeah, look, a couple of teething problems, but nothing that he couldn't sort out.
The whole team were literally around his bikes.
Yeah, look, that's great, isn't it? Because he's just come into the setup, and everybody's helping, pulling together, and that's what this club's about. You know, everybody's trying to help everybody. We all want to win, and we can't. What one person's not going to make all the difference. We're all working hard together.
And you saw that brilliant team riding with Louis Kerr. Steady, thank you. Back to you, Kelv.
Thank you, Abby. Yeah. The panic is over in that respect because he's hit the ground running, he's unbeaten by an opponent, and the Sheffield Tigers take a lead in the match. 2 points up after six heats this evening, 19 points to 17. Good to see them having a chat there, and good to see Louis Kerr back from that accident. Been an important member for the Sheffield Tigers, instrumental in them getting to the grand final last year, no question about that. Although they came up short in the end, there's no doubt that they were delighted with his performances, and they've got to be delighted with the way Ty Woffenden has started tonight as well. I think number seven in the lineup is Dan Bewley on the inside in red, Adam Ellis out of gate number two in white, Norik Bladorn off the gate number three in blue, and Josh Pickering off the outside in yellow. Can the home team now bounce back? They need the points, Bellevue. They've got plenty of races in hand, matches in hand, but you'd rather the points on the board. And here at home, Sheffield Tigers, who beat them here in the National Speedway Stadium earlier this season, they won't want to go down again and be beaten by them about four times in the league matches leading up to the playoffs. Psychologically, that would give the Tigers quite an edge. Bewley showed great speed up against Woffenden in heat number four. Couldn't quite steal the win off of him on that run to the checkered flag. Was very close. No surprise really to see Bewley flying. He is jet propelled most weeks here in Manchester. A rider that is beginning to make his mark in the Grand Prix again, having won the last round in Melilla last month. Great eye-catching rider as well. So riders coming forward now for heat number seven. LWH is under a bit of pressure. Here we go then. Into the first turn, Bewley's got that inside gate. Certainly has worked well in the last few races. Round the outside comes Adam Ellis, coming on strong as well, giving Bewley something to think about. These two boys are actually really good friends. No question about that. Look at Ellis go. Failed to score first time. He's in the grip. Bewley now trying to respond, but Adam Ellis has ridden a stormer there to come through. Bewley and Adam Ellis neck and neck down the back straight through turns three and four as well. Just Pickering is hanging on to third place, keeping Lenore back in fourth. But Adam Ellis, this is some ride from him. Of course, he won the British Championship here just a few short years ago. Got the better of Bewley here. All of a sudden, that outside line is beginning to work. One more lap to go. Bewley hunting down Ellis. Ellis in the grip, charging down the back straight for the last time. Bewley electing to go really tight. Ellis out in the grip. Run to the line. Ellis hangs on. What a speedway race. We are seeing some terrific action here tonight in Manchester. And Adam Ellis coming from the back there to get the better of Dan Bewley. I do hope they're still friends at the end of that. I'm sure they are. But there's no doubt that Adam Ellis has ridden his socks off there to win heat number seven. Ellis then, 3 points for the Tigers, two for Dan Bewley and the Bellevue Aces, one for Josh Pickering and the Sheffield Tigers, and Norik Bladorn misses out for the Bellevue Aces. But Scott, that was some ride from Adam Ellis there to get the better of Dan Bewley.
What a ride. Definitely. I mean, Adam Ellis was the one that was saying to me that gate one wasn't working, so I think he probably hoped he had the advantage over his good mate Dan Bewley on the inside, but it wasn't to be. Dan has done everything right here, but like you said, Kelv, brave, brave ride from Adam Ellis. Just lets a bike run, uses that dirt on the outside, and just sneaks around the outside. Takes him a lap to do it, but we know at Bellevue it's all about building up that momentum. He didn't fall to the pressures of Dan there. He could have tried to drop it on Dan, but he opted to keep out in that dirt. You see how wide he is there. Got to run. Dan Bewley can't stop him. Another great win for the Sheffield Tigers and extend that lead, Kel.
Yeah, and these two are friends, aren't they? They've been together at the Grand Prix. It must have been must have been quite an interesting sort of mindset for Bewley, because he definitely gave him a lot of respect out there.
Yeah, definitely so. And it's kind of one of those things, Adams had a little look out over him there, kind of thinking, oh, he's my mate, he's not going to run me too hard. But you know what it's like when the helmet goes on, Kelv, the goggles go down. Totally different. But man, at the moment, I think Abby's got him.
Yep, he's just taken his helmet off. Adam, you and Dan, good mates. You actually sport the same haircut as well that you both had done for GB in the World Cup, but got the better of him there.
Yeah, it's good. He's quick round here, and it's good to race against him. You know, he's not going to. I know he's not going to stick me through the fence. So it's yeah, good result. Nice to bounce back with that one, and I think the mullets are faster.
Adam, congratulations. I'll let you get ready for your next heat. And here in Manchester, I'll remind you of that hashtag I have seen on social media, and you are getting busy. I will ask Scott Nichols all of your questions during the break on Discovery Plus a little bit later on in the show. We have got some great racing here, and it's just 4 points separating the two teams. We'll be right back. Welcome back to the National Speedway Stadium after seven heats. It's 19:23, so the visitors with a four-point advantage as it stands. Before we resume action, just a reminder of the other sport that's happening, UCI Cycling World Championships Glasgow, and that is tomorrow on Your Sport 2 from 12:25. It's day six of the championships, obviously featuring the track cycling. And then the Premier League starts again, and it starts on TNT Sports 1, 12th of August. It's the kickoff is at 12:30. It's from it's between Arsenal and Nottingham Forest. That's the Emirates Stadium. But the build-up commences from 11 a.m. And then the Athletics World Championship there in Budapest. And it's Eurosport Live 19th to the 27th of August. But in the speedway world, let's head to Peterborough now and get the latest from Dave Rowe.
Close fought contest at the East of England Arena. Peterborough leading by 13 points to 11 after heat four, thanks to two home 5-1s. And Benjamin Basso, very determined indeed in heat five, outgating Emil Saifudinov and going round Eric Riss at the third bend as well. But Saifudinov has been truly spectacular on his two visits to Peterborough this season. He's chasing down Basso here. Basso in red out in front for the Panthers, but Saifudinov gaining ground, gaining speed on the back straight, and then the dive through on the inside. Is there contact there? Well, it certainly forces Benjamin Basso out wide off the fourth bend. Saifudinov steaming through for a 4-2 for the Witches to level the scores. But how about this here in race number six? Fast start by Jason Doyle, who of course was 5-1 in his first ride. He managed to get the better of Chris Harris there on turn one, but the man who's chasing the rider in blue, Patrick Vadewu, the recent Panthers signing. Don't forget he failed to score last week on his debut against Wolverhampton, but a practice after the meeting has certainly done the trick, because Vadewu here in blue going charging through on the inside of Jason Doyle, who is completely stunned by that move and cannot recover either. Chris Harris trying to come back in to make a passing move himself, but superb stuff there by Vadewu on the second lap, and that's going to be a second straight victory for him, making it 8 points from three rides, and plenty of power at reserve for Peterborough this evening, and a 4-2 to put them in front by 19 points to 17. Spectacular victory there by Vadewu, who was back on track in heat seven off the outside gate. This time Niels Christensen making the start from gate two, getting in front of Danny King. Vadewu again trying the move around the outside on King. This time he's slightly blocked out there, but still holding a decent third place in front of Keenan Rue. So Ipswich not having things their own way here, admitting they need to win to keep in touch in the with the Premiership playoff places, and they're dropping 4 points behind at the halfway stage. Vadewu sensational for the Panthers. Everson winning heat seven with seven hits gone. Peterborough 23, Ipswich 19.
Dave, thank you. Let's join Scott Nichols now. I believe he's got some pearls of wisdom about team riding. Scotty?
Well, I love a bit of team ride, Abby. I don't know about pearls of wisdom. We'll see what we've got on my sleeve. But I want to take a look at Ty here. First off, a couple of little things to look at. The start marshal, Ty, he's got lucky with this look, because really his elbow should be inside that white line. I'll let him off for that because he makes such a great start. The important thing is he has a real good look for Louis Coe. He looks there. I'm going to pause it in a second when we come out of the first turn, because as he has another look over his shoulder there, you see Ty looking back. But look at the distance between him and Louis Coe. But also, he'll be aware that Brady Kurtz is right up the inside of him. Even though Brady's not in his peripheral, he will sense him there. He'll also feel that Brady has faded away a little bit, has another little look. But for me, it's Ty's body language coming into this turn here. As a viewer, it's probably hard to explain, but I can see that he's kind of held the bike back. He's not gone in there full throttle. He's not gone in there to attack the corner. Louis Kerr will know that on the outside. It allows Louis to run around the outside to get that all-important 5-1 that the Sheffield Tigers much needed. Ty Wiffenden on his debut here, unbeaten, fantastic night. Looking forward to the rest of it. What do you reckon, Kelv?
Well, I reckon it was a fine bit of team riding. You're absolutely right, and you pointed it out clearly there. And I'm sure this meeting has got plenty to come, plenty of exciting races to come. But home team, 4 points back, needing to respond now. Tom Brennan coming out. He hasn't had the night he was looking for. It's unfortunate for him. Had a chain break in his first ride and then failed to score second time out. So he's out here in heat number eight, and we'll be looking to get amongst the points this time for sure. Team, as I say, will want to win this evening, not just because they want to pick up the points, but the Sheffield Tigers have had a bit of a number on them this season, no doubt about that. So home team under pressure, looking to bounce back here in heat eight at the midway point of the evening. Riders just making their way towards the tapes now. bit of gardening on, bit of track grading going on as well. Almost like they've been tyre packing it in the middle of the corners, maybe a touch heavy there. Line up heat number 8 is Connor Bailey off the inside in blue. Dan Gilkes out of gate number 2 in yellow. Tom Brennan out of gate number 3 in red. And Carl Howarth off the outside in white. Good matchup with those two lads on the outside riding at number 2 tonight. Connor Bailey, who run his first ride in heat number 2 in terrific style, actually. He looked really impressive indeed. And Dan Gilkes has had a tough night so far. Hasn't managed to pick up a point so far this evening. Looking to do better this time in heat number 8. 14 points is the difference on aggregate. So right now, the Sheffield Tigers are in charge of that. As I say, Bellevue looking to just win the night at very least to pick up 2 league points, if at all possible. If they don't, Sheffield Tigers effectively might be doing Ipswich a favour, but Ipswich are having a tough night in Peterborough. League number 8 takes up. Away we go. This time, out of gate number 3. It's all about Tom Brennan. He fires himself to the front, and the Bellevue Aces are bouncing back here. Connor Bailey through into second place as well. Brennan, who's had a really disappointing evening so far, is almost certainly bouncing back nicely here and looking terrific. Really does get away sharply and is enjoying himself out in front, and that'll make him feel an awful lot better. Bailey in the points once again, and Carl Howard being distanced here with Dan Gilkes, who's having a tough night at Speedway out the back. But I tell you what, Tom Brennan looking terrific out in front. Really turning on the speed and the style. Such a fast track here in the National Speedway Stadium. A big power track. If you haven't got it all hooked up, you really are at a disadvantage. But this time, Tom Brennan in dominant mood. Really coming to the party just when his team needed it. Crowd on their feet. Brennan terrific. Connor Bailey also doing a great job back in second place. They needed points, the home team, and they come through in flying colours in heat number 8. Massive 5-1. First 5-1 of the evening for the home side, on board, of course, with Connor Bailey. They'll be delighted about that, and Mark Lemon, the team manager, also. He would have been a touch concerned with going 4 points behind. Now there's just nothing in it. 24 points apiece. Squares it all up. So the result of heat number 8 is a good ride for Tom Brennan, much more like it. 3 points for him. Connor Bailey having a great night. 2 points for him in second place. Carl Howard's back in third, 1 point, and Dan Gilkes misses out for the third time this evening. But there's no doubt about it, Tom Brennan, Scott, bouncing back to top form. Got a couple of lads down there as well.
Got a couple of the teammates here. They'll just see how bad that race was for him. It's unfortunate. The Bellevue Aces hit back with a 5-1, Kelv, and Adam Ellison shot there. Had a great race last time out, but it wasn't to be for the Sheffield Tigers this time. Gates 2 and 4 not working for them. Kyle Howarth tried the outside line, but it's just a little bit too wet, a little bit greasy. Perhaps I misread the track there, Kelv, but got to give a lot of credit to Connor Bailey tonight, Kelv. He's rode exceptionally well, follows his teammate home here for a much-needed 5-1 for the Aces.
Yeah, Connor Bailey looks a useful performer. He won heat 2 really nicely, and he's done a really good job in heat number 8, doing a good job for the Aces tonight, isn't he?
He certainly has, Kelv. He's on the inside here of Tom Brennan as the race settles down. From the long track days, you'll know it exceptionally well, Kelv, to stay out of the way of the roost, meaning the dirt that flies up off the back wheel, it really does hinder your race, slows you up, and it actually really hurts. But now come that Jamie Lindsay, he really has been on form, Kelv.
He has indeed. Ty Woffenden coming out, so a bit of a showdown here. Ty Woffenden unbeaten by an opponent, settling in very nicely and swiftly. Made 2 very good starts, really sharp away from the tapes, as has Jamin Lidsey. So we'll see what's going to give here. Will Jamin Lidsey remain unbeaten? Two lads are just having a bit of a chat down the back straight. Ty Woffenden clearly enjoying his return to British Speedway, no doubt about that. Jamin Lidsey out of gate number 3 here, and Woffenden off gate number 2, so it could be quite a tussle going towards the first turn. Louis Kerr, fine ride last time as well, so no doubt about it. Heat number 9, pressure still on the home team, nothing to choose between the two teams, 24 points apiece. Charles Wright hasn't had the evenings he was looking for so far, just 1 point from a couple of outings, so looking to get amongst the points this time. Line-up heat number 9, Charles right off the inside in the blue helmet colour. Ty Wolfenden out of gate number two in white. Jamin Lidsing out of gate number three in red. And gate number four in yellow is Louis Kerr. Kerr can be a spoiler. When he's in the mood, he can be fast and a sharp starter as well. And that's a great combo to have, no doubt about that. Jamin Lidsey, who's been in terrific form around the National Speedway Stadium this year. As I say, he's had a couple of rides and he's unbeaten and it's been really quick out in front. And there's no question that he'll be wanting to lower the colours of Ty Wolfenden here if he can. Bit of momentum back with the home team after heat number eight with that 5-1. Timely 5-1, I might add, as well. So we're looking towards two big guns going head-to-head here once again. Heat number nine, green light is about to come on, it is. Once again, absolutely electric away from the tape. Charles Wright coming through into second place. Certainly down the back straight, it's tight, but Jamin Lidsey just about hanging on to third place there. But Ty Wolfenden in real mood tonight, no question about that. So sharp on the tapes, great to see. Looking fast out in front, beginning to pull away with Louis Kerr, his teammate, trapped at the back. But the three-time former world champion, back in Britain, looking good, really enjoying himself. And you can just see the body language on the bike, relaxed, bike going further and further away. Really eye-catching ride here from Wolfenden. Charles Wright and Lidsey, they can do nothing about it. Louis Kerr now tailed off in fourth place. But this evening, with Ty Wolfenden coming back to the sport, he's going to remain unbeaten by an opponent. And I tell you what, he is certainly looking fabulous out there. Terrific ride for Wolfenden. 3 points for him. Sheffield Tigers packing in for second and third, so the meeting remains locked at 27 points apiece. So it's a tight contest, an exciting contest, but Wolfenden, no doubt about it, looking good out there this evening. So Ty Wolfenden, 3 points for him. Charles Wright back in second place, 2 points. Jamin Lidsey back in third, 1 point for him. And Louis Kerr misses out in heat number nine. But Scott, I tell you what, I'm right across the start line and Ty has been absolutely nailing these starts.
Do you know what, Kelv? I'm so glad you said that because the actual running of that was from kind of slightly behind Ty Wolfenden. And just watching him at the start, he was so composed on the bike. And as he dumped the clutch, he kind of, his whole body, bike and everything was in sync. And it just, this here just fired him to the first turn. Jamin Lidsey off gate three, whatever they were talking about, he must have psyched him out because Jamin Lidsey was backed in third place. I know his teammate was in second and it's not really the done thing to race your teammate, but Ty Wolfenden out front just looks silky smooth, looks fast, looks like he's enjoying his bike. And I've got to say, Kelv, he's having a tough, tough time in the Grand Prix. Could this be the tonic he needs just to give him that little bit of love, that little bit of passion, and more importantly, enjoyment back in his racing?
It's not going to do him any harm, Scott, that's for sure. Winning races isn't a good thing. And there's no doubt that it hasn't done any harm for Saifutinov, who's riding really well in the Premiership. Haven't got long to wait to see the response, of course, in the Grand Prix with Ty Wolfenden. Riga this weekend in Latvia, which is round number seven. But nonetheless, so far this evening, Ty Wolfenden has done an outstanding job for the Sheffield Tigers. So heat number 10 at 27 points apiece between the two. Sheffield Tigers with Adam Ellis, who was in sparkling form in his last ride after failing to score first time out, got the better of Dan Bewley. Tom Brennan out here once again for his fourth ride of the evening. And he'll be looking to continue on after a really terrific ride in heat number eight. No doubt about that, looked like he had plenty of speed indeed. Difficult to call this meeting, really is. It's so tightly and closely matched, no doubt about that. Number 10, then the lineup. It's Tom Brennan off the inside in blue. Josh Pickering out of gate number two in yellow. Brady Kurtz away from gate number three in red. And Adam Ellis off the outside in white. Kurtz is a fast charger, no doubt about that. But needs to get his nose in front tonight. He's had a second and a third so far. So he'll be looking to pick up a win if at all possible. But Adam Ellis, after that confidence-boosting ride when he got the better of Dan Bewley, after failing to score first time out, he'll be looking to try and repeat that if at all possible. There is the man, Adam Ellis. As I say, riders just packing the dirt in to try and find the best possible place to start from. Mark Lemon. Not smiling now. A little bit more concern on his face. Bellevue Aces, of course, proud club, won the league title last year after an eternity, it seemed, before their previous championship winning team. They got so close in previous years, but just come up short. But last year they sealed the deal, and they want to do it again in 2023, that's for sure. Team number nine. Away go. Into the first corner. And that's a terrific start from Brennan. Here comes Kurtz charging through as well. Gets the better of picking with Adam Ennis out the back. But Brennan, after a desperately disappointing start to the evening, is much more like his old self. Ball is tight here. Throw a blanket over all of them. And Ennis coming through into third place. Now Kurtz has hit the front with Tom Brennan back in second place. Pickering also in the mix here. Nothing to choose between the four riders now. Ennis in the middle of the track trying to get the better of Brennan. But the home team, they need points. A heat advantage here. Look at Brady. Kurtz round that first turn. Wow, he's gone wider than anybody. Beginning to pick the speed up. And he really looks fabulous on the bike. Ennis is now dropping back in third place. And the home team certainly stamping their authority on heat number 10. Kurtz has done it again. And he's generated a huge amount of speed out in front. Spectacular ride from the captain of the Aces. He wins his first race of the night, and it's a terrific result for the home team as well. They pick up the maximum score. Could be pivotal in the outcome of this evening's events, I'm sure. 5-1 in heat number 10. And the Aces, all of a sudden, they've got a lead here of 4 points. As I say, a very handy lead indeed. And Brady Kurtz looked fabulous out there in heat number 10, home team. The home crowd delighted with that performance, and Tom Brennan coming through to pick up the paid win as well. So 3 points for Brady Kurtz out in front. Super ride. Tom Brennan back in second place, 2 points for him. Adam Ennis back in third, 1 point. Josh Pickering fails to score in heat 10, Scott, but Brady Kurtz, when he gets that run around the outside, it looks terrific.
Oh, it certainly does, Kelv. I feel for Josh Pickering here. He wasn't really too sure where to go in the first turn. To me, he didn't really do too much wrong other than the fact that Brady Kurtz read that first turn perfectly and cut back up the inside. See Josh Pickering here, he's kind of sandwiched in the middle. He's kind of lets a bike run out there, thinks he's going to generate that speed around the outside, but Brady Kurtz was not going to let that happen. And I've got to be honest, Kelv, I'm not sure if Brady Kurtz watched Tyber from the team riding, because he certainly didn't do anything untoward on this first turn here, but it certainly wasn't team riding up the inside. And the fact he was riding so wide late on, Kelv, probably tells me that he had a very tall gear on, needed to keep that speed up, needed to keep that momentum going, otherwise that bike would have stalled.
Well, he actually looks over his right shoulder and there's nobody
there,
so he has a sneaky look back to his left. But all's well that ends well. And it was a big, big performance and a handy 5-1 for the home team, no question about that. 32 points to 28, so a 4-point lead now for the Bellevue Aces. All of a sudden, a little bit of comfort there. We'll see Dan Bewley out for the third time this evening, and Dan hasn't won a race yet. Has looked very useful, but hasn't quite managed to win a race so far this evening. Ty Wolfenden just having a chat with Simon Stead. Keeping an eye on what's going on, see if they can bounce back here with Tavares Michalak and Carl Howarth for the visitors. Riders approaching the tapes, getting to the business end of the evening now, where it's really going to have to come good if you can. But with Tom Brennan coming to the party as well, I think that's been quite pivotal for the Bellevue Aces. Line up for heat number 11 with Tavares Michalak on the inside in the white helmet colour. Dan Bewley out of gate number 2 in red. Carl Howarth from gate number 3 in yellow, and Norit Bladon off the outside in blue. Dan Bewley will be very keen to get to winning ways. This is an opportunity, but Michalak on the inside gate will be a tough nut to crack. Michalak is a handy performer. Carl Howarth also for the Tigers will be a hard charging. Norit Bladon will have his hands full on the run to the first corner, there's no question about that. No quarter given. Michalak, who's had a win and a second place tonight, so started strongly. Dan Bewley, who's just been out-battled. Adam Ellis lowered his colours last time. That was a smashing speedway race between two good friends on and off the track. really doing a lot of gardening there, and Michalak likewise, packing the dirt in. So riders coming forward now, settling down for heat number 11. Tigers now looking to respond, 4 points behind, and they get a heat advantage here. Takes up, Julius made it. That's more like it from Dan Bewley, absolutely did, nailed it. Ladorn also up the inside, coming through there, but Howarth has certainly got the better of it, and Michalak also up the inside of Ladorn. It was the meat in the sandwich down the back straight. But Bewley will be a hard man to take back now. He gets out in front, and look at that. That is just top quality for Bewley now. Michalak and Howarth hanging on in second and third. They're going to have to keep Ladorn quiet, because Ladorn is lurking back in fourth place. Bewley's away. They're now going to have to do the team riding between the two of them, Howarth and Michalak, with Ladorn there just beginning to drift away in fourth place. Bewley back to winning ways here. Got to be. Lapping a bit to go. Out in front. Howarth there with Michalak just beginning to come through into second place, and they swap positions. One last blast down the back straight. Bewley cruising to his first win of the night. Superstar from gate number two. That really did the business for them. And, the home team maintain their 4-point lead, moving on to 35 points to 31. And Bewley, once he hits the front, is a very difficult man to peg back. He has so much speed. He weighs, well, he's lighter than a feather. There's very little of him at all. And once he gets going, mightily impressive. So 3 points for Dan Bewley and the Bellevue Aces. Michalak coming through in the second place, 2 points for him. Howarth in third, 1 point for him. And Norik Ladorn misses out in heat number 11. But there's no doubt about it, Scott. Dan Bewley is a fine sight when he gets out in front like that.
Oh, he certainly is, Kelvin. Surprised they had to wait for heat 11 for Dan to win the race. But like you said, he's exceptionally light. I can confidently say that my right leg probably weighs more than Dan Bewley. But that just goes to show, power to weight ratio, he's gone. Out front, he makes a brilliant start. Michalak just goes nowhere off the inside gate there. I'm not sure really what went wrong there for him, but Dan Bewley just streaks out in front. Norik Ladorn here gets swallowed up by the two Sheffield boys, and they had to kind of team ride for a little bit just to keep him at bay. They got the three points, but more importantly for Dan Bewley out front, the first race win for him, that'll do his world confidence. And there you go, 3 points for Dan Bewley, much needed for the Bellevue Aces. Dan, to you, Abby.
Thank you. I'm going to try and speak to Mark Lemon. He's actually with Norik Ladorn looking at the bike. Mark, got your mechanical hat on at the moment?
Yeah, I've just obviously just seeing how the rider feels and if we can make some changes. So obviously Norik did not a lot wrong there, to be in all fairness, and the bike probably just didn't get in there down the back straight. So we can just change something, tweak it a little bit and go again. But yeah, tight meeting.
Really tight. It's close meeting. Dan Bewley getting his first heat win. It's what you expect with the sort of hype that surrounds Ty Wiffenden coming in. But for a team manager perspective, too tight for you?
We always kind of expected this one to be a tough one. In fairness, they've got, obviously, it's the War of the Roses. It means a lot to a lot of people. Yeah, the first half of the meeting, don't really panic too much because everyone's sort of finding their feet. Track conditions are a little bit different than the normal. But I think we've got enough in the tank. But yeah, no, Ty's obviously rallying the boys up, doing a good job. But our team, you know, very methodical. And we've got a system that's in place and it's working quite well. But it's Speedway at the end of the day.
And we'll have more Speedway next Monday. And it goes to an individual event in terms of the British final back at the National Speedway Stadium. Dan will be coming back to defend his title. But we've got so many past champions as well that are going to be back trying to get that title off him.
Yeah, sure. I mean, obviously, we've got Charles and Tom Brennan in the field as well. So, there's a very big appetite for the Bellevue fans. But, it's a very prestigious event. And we're really honoured that we can stage you at the National Speedway Stadium. And we look forward to that. But tonight, we'll just concentrate what's in front of us right now.
Yeah, it is a tight margin. It is just 4 points. And I'll just say thank you to you, Mark, because we are now ready for the draw. And this will determine the riding order next week in the British final. Scott Nichols is with Phil Morris.
Yeah, thanks. Have a good draw in a second. I'm joined by biker legend John McGuinness. Just real quickly, John, you're here, Ty Wiffenden back on British soil. What do you make of the meeting tonight?
Fantastic, yeah. Good close racing. I don't know which way it's going to go, but I'm excited for the back end of the meeting. But you've got world-class riders here doing their thing around one of the best tracks in the world, so it's awesome.
Certainly it is a world-class track. We're going to do that draw now. John is going to pull the names out. We're going in alphabetical order, so and Phil Morris is going to call them. First up is Ben Barker. We're going to see what draw number is going to come out at.
So Ben Barker will be draw number 9.
So next up out of the pot is going to be the defending champion, Dan Bewley.
Dan Bewley will be start number 15.
Next up is homeboy Tom Brennan.
Tom Brennan, start number 8.
Next up, former Bellevue ace, Craig Cook.
Craig Cook will be start number 5.
So, yeah, quick look at the first four that are out of the hat then. So we've got Ben Barker, Dan Bewley, Tom Brennan and Craig Cook.
Yeah, I think it's good there. You've got Craig Cook as draw number 5, which is statistically the best draw number in the Grand Prix. And I think also Dan Bewley drew number 13 maybe, which was probably the second best number. So
unlucky for some, but number 5 is the one. So next cracking on. Next up is Adam Ellis.
Adam Ellis is start number 2.
After Adam Ellis comes Leon Flint from the Berwick Bandits and Wolverhampton Wolves.
Leon Flint will be start number 12.
After that is the British man himself, Chris Harris.
Chris Harris will be start number 10.
And next in the block of four lining up will be Kyle Howarth.
And Kyle Howarth will be start number 4.
So we see the next block of four there is Adam Ellis. Coming up in a second, we'll see Adam Ellis, Leon Flint, Chris Harris and Kyle Howarth. Statistically there, Phil, is there a good one?
Yeah, I would say Adam Ellis has probably had one of the worst draws. Statistically, number 3 is not a great one, but number 2 is not the greatest one. 2 and 3 struggle a little bit.
Phil, we said we were going to keep it positive, mate. You've just thrown the right. You just dampened his night already. Anyway, next up is Louis Kerr.
Louis Kerr is start number 14.
Next out of the hat, former British champion Danny King.
Danny King is start number 6.
Next up, having a great season so far, Simon Lambert.
Simon Lambert will be start number 1.
And last up in this block of four is Richard Lawson.
And Richard Lawson will be start number 13.
So there'll be a graphic come up any second with that block of four there for their draw numbers. Phil, is there any positives to take from that?
Yeah, I think statistically number 13 and number 1 are quite good. They both get gate ones twice, so I'm sure they'll be happy with that.
And gate one early doors in the Grand Prix is hugely important. So next up, Howarth and Ellis up in the first heat there, so pretty tasty one. Anyway, next block of four, number 13 on the list is Rory Schlein.
Rory Schlein will be start number 7.
Then next up we'll have the two brothers. First off it'll be Richie Worrell.
Richie Worrell will be start number 3.
And then his brother, not sure which is older or younger, but Stevie Worrell.
Stevie Roll will be start number 11.
And last up in the block is the Bellevue ace himself, Charles Wright.
And Charles Wright will be the final number, start number 16.
So here's a final look. That is your draw from the top to the bottom.
Yeah, I think there's some strong riders there. Obviously, former British champions. I won't mention Richie Wallace, statistically the worst draw for numbers, but yeah, there's some big names there, and I'm sure the best man will win on the night.
There certainly is, but you know what? It's always the gate draws. We make so much hype about it in the Grand Prix, but like in the Grand Prix, it comes down to one race, that final race. Who's going to be the British champion? Over to you, Abby.
Scotty, thank you. Just a reminder then of that hashtag, because during the break, I'll be speaking to Scott Nichols on Discovery Plus about your thoughts on, well, that British final that is just 7 days' time here at the National Speedway Stadium. And also, it's a very tight contest here in Manchester between Bellevue and Sheffield Tigers. So that hashtag is Belshi. And join us on Discovery Plus, where I'll be putting Scott Nichols under the spotlight with your thoughts and opinions. We've got 4 heats remaining here in Manchester, just 4 points separating the two sides. the part of the night where my brain works in overdrive. Okay,
and let's. I panic.
Okay, so the first one, Scotty, from Chris Cooper. Great to see the Speedway serving up some great action and still surviving without some of the great teams. Is there an update on Coventry and Swindon? Because it'd be great to see that they're not forgotten.
No, they're certainly not forgotten. Swindon, I don't know so much about. Coventry, I know they're pushing exceptionally hard. They've got a GoFundMe page because they need, obviously, to get some legal action in. But they're in a good position. I've got everything crossed for them because, obviously, I've got fond memories of Coventry. It's such a nostalgic stadium. So hopefully we can see those back and that can have a knock-on effect for Swindon and clubs alike.
Yeah, absolutely. This is from Nicholas Papilla. I hope I'm pronouncing your monikers right. Belshi, what attracts all stars to the British League right now?
Do you know what? I think that the standard of the racing has gone up, and I think, you know, racing in Poland, and I think a lot of it is the pressures. I mean, Ty said earlier that he kind of enjoyed it here. I know Emil has said that, I mean, he's having a fantastic year, and the pressure's not the same. Doesn't mean to say that the racing is not just as intense, but I think the outside, because it's not such a big sport here as it is in perhaps Poland, I think it's more enjoyable, and I think it's somewhere that they can hone their skills.
This is from Shockster. I wonder if this changes. I mean, it won't now, obviously, if it's 7 days notice, but it says GB captain not riding in the British final. Think people would like to know why, he's especially now he's riding in the UK.
Well,
thanks, Shockster.
It's a little bit late to chuck someone that's represented or kind of served British Speedway, you know, for the whole season to then put Ty in. Yes, it would be great to see Ty and the likes in there, but, you know, he's come back, so next year then perhaps he will be.
And a lighter note now, it's quite a few people have said about this as well. Ty Wifford and Louis Kerr must be the most tattooed pairing in GB Speedway right now.
I don't think there's much left that's not tattooed. I'll leave that one to you guys.
You've got a few tats as well, but also, you know, in more.
Yeah, I can cover them up quite easily.
Okay, let me just see if there's anything else before I come back to just talking about the British final. Obviously there you saw the riding order. I heard Phil Morris talk about Adam Ellis saying he had the worst draw, but for Dan Bewley and a few others, some really good ones. What are your thoughts?
It is, you know, it's the gate positions can have a lot of emphasis, and Phil's obviously got statistics from the Grand Prix, and it does make a difference, especially somewhere like here where, you know, I think Richie Worrell, bless him, has not got good gate draw, but so much can happen in those first turns, so much can happen during a race, so you've got to kind of put that to back of your mind. Everybody ups their game for British final, that's one thing I know for sure.
And obviously there is the wild card in Cardiff that's up for grabs. Unless Dan Bewley wins, then it will go to the second place. But looking at those all those names now, and so many previous British champions, who do you think is obviously beyond Dan Bewley?
Do you know what? I think that's what's exciting. It opens it wide up. I mean, Adam Ellis, a former champion, we've seen him racing great tonight. Bomber Harris always lifts his game. Rory Schlein, another point to prove. So, you know, it's a home boys too.
All to look forward to in 7 days' time. So with just four heats remaining, it's just 4 points separating the two sides, 35-31 as it stands. Let's head to Peterborough and get the latest from Dave Rowe.
Well, a tense contest here with Peterborough 4 points in front after seven races. Ipswich sitting on a 5-1 in heat eight with Eric Riss and Dan Thompson. Riss has been really impressive so far, but it's the rider in blue, Jordan Jenkins, steaming down the inside of Dan Thompson to try and split the Witches combination. And a good pass there by Jenkins to prevent a 5-1. Thompson fighting back on turn two, but Jenkins back round the outside, and that was a 4-2 to the Witches. Heat nine was shared to win for Jason Doyle over Ben Cook and Benjamin Basso, but heat number 10, watch this from the Panthers with Chris Harris, the rider in red, trying to turn back on the inside of Danny King. He's done so. Way out in front is Patrick Voidereau once again. He has been superb for Peterborough this evening as Chris Harris comes down the inside of Danny King once more. That's a 5-1 to put them 6 points in front after 10 races, 33 points to 27. Heat number 11, an absolute belter as the Witches try and hit back. Niels Krishnevason is the rider in red going either side of him. Emil Seifudinov and Eric Riss into the third bend. They hit the third bend in a 5-1 situation. Everson fighting back hard though on Seifudinov to get back past him. into the second lap. Not too much room there on the home straight, and Sifudinov almost hemmed in behind his teammate Ritters. Iversen goes back for the outside into the third bend. Neck and neck stuff. Fair stuff as well. Sifudinov sending Iversen out wide as he moves through into second place. Iversen will fight back once again. Can tell you elsewhere, by the way, a close contest at Monmore Green, where Leicester lead by 2 points at Wolverhampton with four races to go, 34-32. They were 8 points in front at one stage, but this dramatic race number 11 with the battle raging on at the showground between Sifudinov, Riss and Iversen. And Iversen now trying to get through on the inside of Riss on the final bend, turn three and four. Fight for the finish line with Sifudinov taking the flag and Riss in second place over Iversen. Fantastic race. Ipswich back in the meeting. 11 gone. Peterborough 34, Ipswich 32.
Close contest in Peterborough and a close match here in Bellevue as well. Let's resume action with Calvin Tatum.
Heat number 12. Line up for you. Louis Kerr on the inside in yellow. Jamin Lidsey out of gate number 2 in red. Adam Ellis out of gate number 3 in white. And Connor Bailey will go from the outside in yellow. 4 points the difference. Four races left, so time running out now for the Sheffield Tigers. They need a bounce back. We've got a huge race in Heat 13. Don't miss that. Don't miss that. Jamin Lidsey dropped points in his last one, looking to bounce back now. Adam Ellis, who had a terrific ride earlier on when he beat Dan Bewley, so he's looking to keep that going now. Kerr back in the sport. 5 points from three outings, doing a good job on his return after that nasty collarbone injury. Broke the collarbone and it's only just 4 weeks, no operation, so he's done well. Heat number 12. Here we go. Gate 2 makes that bike work a treat to the first corner. He gets himself to the front. The Tigers are coming through in second and third down the back straight. It's all about Adam Ellis and Louis Kerr now coming under pressure. Lots of pressure from Connor Bailey. Connor Bailey's done well there to come through into third place, but Lidsey looking like a winning right from there. Adam Ellis down the back straight, battling hard. The Tigers are coming under all sorts of pressure here with the Bellevue Aces responding terrifically well after, no doubt, that the Tigers really laid down the gauntlet earlier on. Lindsay fast out in front. Adam is going nicely in second place. And Connor Bailey once again riding so very well here this evening. Back in third, that vital third place will give you the heat advantage. No question about that. Going to stretch their lead and they're now beginning to make an impact on the aggregate point as well here, the Bellevue Aces. Super stuff from Lindsay. Roars for another win tonight. Adam Ellis back in second place. Bailey riding well. Louis Kerr there just getting a little despondent on the run to the line, failing to score. But Jamin Lidsey, when he gets that bike hooked up, is mightily impressive indeed and showed a great turn of speed there in heat number 12. 3 points for Lidsey. Adam Ellis back in second place, 2 points for him. Connor Bailey riding well tonight, 1 point for him, and Louis Kerr misses out in heat number 12. That means that there's now a 6 point advantage for the Bellevue Aces. And Scotty, Jamin Lidsey, he sort of straightens his back, doesn't he? And he makes that bike really dig into the first corner.
It really did well picked out there, Kelvin. Like, really forces into the seat, willing that bike forward, getting all the traction there. Good shot from the outside there. See the tapes fly up. Connor Bailey can't quite get there initially, but he works hard. Rode fantastically well tonight. Works hard to get around the outside of Louis Kerr to get himself into third place and help extend that lead for the Bellevue Aces. But Jamin Lidsey out front, he's just out of shot here. He's going so well, but Jamin Lidsey had that blip earlier on. Rockets way over the lead. But you see Louis Kerr there trying to cut back. And I think that collarbone still possibly giving a little bit of grief. I've seen a few of the moves that he's made where he seems a little bit hesitant, a little bit resistant to really force a bite. But Adam Ellis there, he's riding very, very well, but certainly can't do anything to claw that lead back on Jamin Lidsey.
Okay, just 4 points in the aggregate now. That is important. 3 points is up for grabs here, no question about it. But we are now focusing our attentions on Heat 13. And the lineup is spectacular, no question about that. Dan Bewley and Ty Wiffenden going head-to-head once again. And just throw into the mix Brady Kurtz and Tobias Michelet. Don't take your eyes off of it. It really is quite something. British Speedway, no question about it, delivering the stars and delivering the quality here in the National Speedway Stadium this evening. crucial now for the Tigers. They've gone 6 points down. They don't want to go any further down, although they can use a tech sub in the next one if they choose to, if they are still 6 points down at the conclusion of Heat 13. Line up for Heat 13 then. Brady Kurtz off the inside in red. Tavares Michalak out of gate number two in white. Dan Bewley out of gate number three in blue. And Ty Woofenden off the outside in yellow. Bewley and Ty Woofenden ride together in Poland. Up against it here, head to head. Woofenden unbeaten so far by an opponent. Eight paid nine so far for Ty Woofenden on his return to the sport. Bewley had a terrific ride last time, won his first race of the night, so he sits on 7 points so far this evening from his three rides. As I say, just 4 points in the aggregate, so there's no doubt that Bellevue Aces are scrapping hard here. They want to pick up maximum points if at all possible, but so you wouldn't like to call Heat 13. This is going to be some tussle, that's for sure, with genuine quality across the start line, no doubt about that. Woofenden has been making starts for fun tonight. He really has. He's been really sharp away from the gates. Everything moving forward at the right moment. Gate four might be a challenge. Here we go then. Take your eyes off this one. Green light is on. Take time. Julie's made a great start. Michalak's there as well. Kurtz on the inside. Michalak. Oh, Woofenden's gone down. Woofenden's gone down. And certainly, yeah, the red lights have come on. Michalak pulled a massive locker in front of Ty Woofenden. And Woofenden there had to bail off the bike. Probably felt that he was going to run into his teammate there, and as a consequence, just sort of had to sort of take avoiding action, and he went down. I'm expecting all four back. I sincerely hope we have all four back here. We'll see it again. Charging into the first corner. Kurtz up the inside. Bewley's made a great start, but Michalak pulls a massive locker there. Almost turns the bike inside out. Yeah, Woofenden's done a terrific job there to put the bike down. And fell awkwardly in the end, so there's going to have to be some running repairs here for Ty. It may well be a small delay. But Craig Aykroyd hasn't made any decisions yet. But Woofenden makes his way back to his pit bay. Takes her up here once again. And as I say, Bewley's made a lovely start there. Kurtz is up the inside, but there, just there. Michalak is unsettled, and Woofenden then has to just put the bike down and spins around himself. It's looking good for the Aces at this point. So they've got the way nicely off of gates one and three. They're just going to cross a slick patch there, and it's the back bike is almost gone into reverse there, and that, as a consequence, means that Woofenden has to put the bike down. Well, all four riders are back in the rerun, and there is no doubt that the home crowd are not best pleased with that. A resounding boo coming out of the crowd with the announcement of all four back. I, for one, as a neutral, am delighted that we have all four back in the rerun. Craig Aykroyd took his time, but of course, the home crowd not best pleased that possibly felt that Woofenden should have. So Mark Lemon on the phone to the referee now.
I'm saying Brady ran him in deep, so can't
really remember that. So Scotty, you saw that. I don't know what your thoughts were on that particular incident, but for me, I think it was a case of, you know, maybe should have been all four back.
I think 100%, Kelv. I mean, I think Michalak was definitely unsettled by Brady Kurtz in the first turn. It's tight first corner. It's hard to say if there was any contact. It looked like there was minimal contact, but definitely, you know, body language. Michalak's not going to go into the corner with his leg necessarily back. You can see here, Brady Kurtz on the inside. Michalak there's leaning. Look at his body language. He's rolled off the gas. His whole body position is kind of leaning wrong into the turn. His weight is back. Look at where his leg is, hence why he's pulled the big locker. Like you said, Kelv, Ty does exceptionally well to take avoiding action to miss Michalak. For me, 100% the right call.
Yep. And There's a lot of people in the stadium that disagreed. There was a little bit of contact there with the dirt deflector on the front of Mushilak's bike. That may well have been contributing to him just getting a little bit out of shape there.
And I think it's just the body language, isn't it, Kelvin? You can see by Mushilak the way he entered the turn, the way he's laying on the bike. That's when you're anticipating almost the contact. Even if there isn't contact, he was anticipating there being some contact. Obviously, unfortunately, it looks like tyres bars have been bent. I can see here, actually, where I'm standing, that left handlebar. The left-hand side of the handlebar, sorry, is bent, so they're desperately going to try and change that. The bike did flip. You saw it land on those handlebars, and you know, Kelv, it's really hard to ride when your handlebars are not straight.
It is indeed. So they're under pressure there to get that bike. Well, certainly the handlebars swapped over, so he feels comfortable on the rerun or fall back. But they will come under pressure. No doubt that they will be given a decent amount of time, but all hands on deck down there. Crucial race, of course, for the Tigers. 6 points behind. They need to grab something out of heat number 13, if at all possible. Sometimes too many hands, they'll get in each other's way, but no question, everybody's getting involved there. No doubts about that. Let's get back down to Scott. He can take a closer look at it.
Yeah, we've got it on the telestrap. I'll stand out the way a little bit here. We're just going to press play. Obviously, Mushilak in the white is the one you're going to see there. I'm going to get my little doodler out in a second. I love having me doodle a bit. Right there. So if I just go forward a little bit here, this is where his whole body language. Look where he's leaning. He's anticipating the contact of the bike there. All the other boys are much more in an upright position on the bike, ready to go. And as we can see here, he goes in, bang, goes off. If I just skip back, I mean, look at that. Look at his whole body language compared to everybody else. Upright. Leaning over, that tells you that your bike, the body is going to go down. Ty Wuffner does exceptionally well to miss him, and you can see there, boom, that's where the bike bounces, left handlebar bent, and obviously they're working really hard to get down the pits. Abby, what have you got for us?
Scotty, I've got Simon Stead. Simon, the Bellevue fans weren't happy with the decision from the ref, but you think it's right, all fall back?
Honestly, Abby, I think we were perhaps a little bit touch fortunate there, but you know, you've got to have a little bit of luck, and we probably got a little bit there, but I don't think there's a right or wrong decision. It could have gone either way, so but a bit of luck goes our way that time, and gives our boys a second chance.
6 points down. It's been a tight meeting tonight. We've been seeing shots of the team just around Ty Wuffner's bike, particularly Josh Pickering. Is he the main mechanic of the team?
I think anybody's chipping in. There's that much to do. We've got all hands on deck.
Look, look, this is important for you guys to get the win. You've brought Ty in, obviously, on Jack Holder's injury replacement. Do you think you can still do it? It's a tight meeting.
Really tight meeting. And obviously we've got the aggregate to think about as well. We won by 10 at our place, so I'm thinking about that. And, well, the meeting's far from over. It's six in it. Anything can happen over the next 3 heats.
Steady, thank you. Back to you, Kelvin.
Thank you, Abby. Still everything to race for here, no question about that. Ty Wuffner under pressure with the clock running down now. The 2 minutes is on. There's just 1.5 minutes left. Bike's ready. They've managed to swap the handlebars over. They were keeping their fingers crossed that the rest of the bike is straight. Wuffner coming back out now. Got gate number 4. Tense times these, particularly for the Sheffield Tigers. 6 points down. They need a result in heat 13. They've got time. Points available. And Wuffenden on his way back to the start for the restaging of heat number 13. Tense times here in the National Speedway Stadium, no question about that. You can't take your eyes off of it. Line up then for heat number 13. Brady Kurtz off the inside in red. Tobias Mushilak off gate number 2 in white. Dan Bewley out of gate number 3 in blue. And Ty Wuffenden will go from the outside in the yellow helmet colour. Bewley quite close to gate number 4 there. Ron Shaw just having a look at him. And just about, quite often as a home rider, you might get a little bit of more leeway than a visitor. Simon Stead, a pensive look on his face now, looking for his team to try and get a back stuff. But they need a heat advantage here. A 4-2. If it's still 6 points down, I'm fully expecting a move in heat number 14. I wouldn't be surprised if there's a move in heat 14 anyway. Dan Gilkes has had his 3 rides. Possibly a reserve switch there with Louis Kerr coming in. We'll wait and see. Bewley had made a great start. Kurtz had dived up the inside. That unsettled Mushilak in the initial stages of 13. What's going to happen? Second time of asking then. Here we go. They start. Right to the first corner. Mushilak's made a really good start there off of gate number 3.
round the outside is Bewley, Kurtz on the inside, Woodford and all, my goodness, nearly ran in the back of Brady Kurtz there, but Michelak's out in front. Ty Woodford trying to get him up to it as well. Bewley coming through in the second place, chasing hard after Michelak, who made a terrific start initially. Kurtz back in third, Woodford looking like he's going to drop points for the first time this evening. But Michelak doing the job for the Sheffield Tigers, and they need it. They're still going to be 6 points down if it stays like this. Bewley now winding it on, coming on stronger. Woodford putting Kurtz on. There's two races in one here. Now, Bewley running high and wide, generating more and more speed. Michelak having to ride with eyes on the back of his head. Bewley on the inside. What a move from Dan Bewley. Slams the door shut down the back straight. Kurtz just about hanging on in third. This is top draw speedway there. Dan Bewley, that's a ride. That is a proper speedway race there. Wow, he had some speed there. Michelak just left the door open marginally, and Bewley pounced, squeezed him down the back straight, and comes through with a stunning win in Heat 13. It's a great result for home team. They now move 8 points in front. Crowd rightly on their feet here as Dan Bewley comes round on the celebratory lap. Stunning ride from him. He'll be tough to, pick up that win in Heat 13. What a race it was. Result then, Dan Bewley out in front, 3 points for him. Michelak back in second place, 2 points. Brady Kurtz hangs on for third place, and Woofenden failed to score in Heat number 13. I'll tell you what, Scott, speedway doesn't get too much better than that. That was a stunning ride from Bewley.
It certainly was, Kelv. I'm glad you referenced top draw, because that was in there, mate. It was a brilliant race. That's what we're so used to seeing Dan Bewley do at that moment in point there. He's almost dead last with all three down the back straight. Michelak, what a fantastic start he made there off gate two, leading the way. Here we see it again. Obviously, he had those thoughts of that first rerun. He didn't make sure that didn't happen again. He slammed the door shut on Brady Kurtz, but Dan Bewley, he's so light, so fast. We see him do it time and time again, where he builds up all that momentum on the outside and he just outfoxes Michelak here. He comes up the inside. Michelak is in that dirt in the fastest line, but Dan Bewley just squares a turn off, doesn't do anything dirty, just sets a bike run up enough just to let Michelak know there's no room, got to back off. A 4-2 for the Aces. The pressure is now on the Sheffield Tigers. Be interesting to see if they're going to pull out the stops and bring in a tack sub in this Heat 14. Oh, that was tight. Actually, it was a bit tight than I thought, Kelv, to be fair. I'll take that back.
It was. He slammed the door shut, but it is. We're hearing that Ty Woofenden will come in Heat 14 to replace Dan Gilkes. So they're making the move. They've got to do it.
And, yeah, they do,
Simon Stead having no hesitation.
Done some speed in that last heat, and what a move on Toby.
Yeah, for sure. You know, it's always a good fun race here, but you know, so far tonight it's been pretty good. So we've got another couple of races and try and beat Sheffield for a change.
What's it like racing against Woofy, your teammates in the Extra Liga, your teammates in the Great Britain setup, and now tonight we knew all eyes would be on you two fighting each other off?
No, I don't really look at it too much like that. I'm just stoked to see him riding here and being back in England. I think it's awesome. So just awesome to see him back riding. And yeah, it was always fun to race against too. But as far as beating him, you know, I couldn't really care. It's just I think it's always good speedway when you know, when he's here, or same with a lot of their riders too. So you know, two good teams and some good racing tonight.
It has been some brilliant racing. It's been tight, and at one stage you were 4 points down, but now a nice healthy lead. But I imagine, and actually I say imagine, I know that Steady is putting Ty Woofenden back in Heat 14.
Yeah, you know, for sure they're gonna try and come back at us, but yeah, just keep plugging away and try and beat Sheffield.
Dan, thank you very much. Let's head back to Scott Nichols.
Yeah, thanks, Abby. It's going to be a little bit of time before Ty goes out. And interesting in the background, you're probably wondering what's going on here, and I was too, actually. But Ty obviously had that crash. You're going to see here in a minute. He's going to get a little bit excited and jump up and down on the bike. A few people have asked, and then Josh Pickens have another go too. Have asked what they're trying to do. Well, actually, they probably would have felt that the bike was slightly bent, so they're then trying to straighten the frame out. But actually, some boys back in the day have actually purposely bent the bike so they get more grip, so the bike obviously crabs, so the bike gets more traction. Sometimes it can work for you, sometimes it go against you. I know Kelvin will understand all about this as well, where they have the offset forks now. But in the moment, these bikes can bend so easily, like Ty's handlebars did, and fair play to him to go out there. Heat 13, that's the toughest race of the night, or apart from 15, obviously, to go off gate 4. The pressure would have been on him. And to go out there with a bike that you're perhaps a little bit uncertain about, and if it's not 100% straight, fair play to him. But can he pull out the bag in this one, Kelv? It's a much-needed race win for Ty Woofenden here for the Sheffield Tigers.
Yeah, it is, Scott. They need some backup from Josh Pickering as well. They need a heat advantage. No doubt that 3 points here for the home team, and they will win the night. And they are closing in on the aggregate point as well. As I say, just 2 points in aggregate. There are 8 points up on the night as well. So they are in the driving seat. It's the last throw of the dice for the Sheffield Tigers here at the National Speedway Stadium, with Woofenden coming out for the fifth time this evening. Having to work hard. Didn't fancy being turned upside down, but great commitment to the cause. Mark Lemon will be a lot happier now. John McGuinness on the left there as well. Legend himself, of course, from the TT, loves his speedway, he's always present. Got the feeling he'll be here next week as well. Line up for heat 14, Josh Pickering off the inside in white. Nora Bladorn out of gate number 2 in blue. A tactical substitute with Ty Woofenden for Dan Gilkes, out of gate number 3 in yellow. And Charles Wright goes from the outside in the red helmet colour. 3 points here for the Bellevue Aces. They will clinch the meeting. And every chance of potentially getting the bonus points as well, but T15 will potentially decide that. Heat advantage vital now for the Sheffield Tigers if they want to keep any chance at all of getting something out of tonight's meeting. It's been a hotly contested one, no question about that. The Tigers started brightly. Bellevue Aces just struggling to get to the front. One or two riders finding points hard to come by. Norwich Bladorn has had a difficult evening, just 1 point from 3 outings, but they've battled back very well with Bewley and Lidsey certainly coming to the party when needed. Brennan picking up 5 points in his last two rides. He's 14 now. Big, big race. Starting into the first corner. Bladorn's got there, but Woofenden's alongside him on the outside. Great first corner there from Noy Bladorn. Got a lot of grip coming off turn two on the inside. Now Woofenden beginning to pile on the pressure back in second place. Up the inside as well. Got to get one of them to the front if they want to keep this meeting alive. So tight also with Charles Wright now coming into the picture as well. But Nora Bladorn, who's had a really disappointing evening, is riding superbly well out in front. Now Charles Wright coming through, getting the better of Josh Pickering. Charles Wright on the inside of Woofenden, almost clouts him coming out of turn number two. Super speedway once again, and the home team really putting it to the Tigers in heat number 14. Remains this way, they're going to win on the evening. And they're going to be in charge of the aggregate point as well. One last chance down the back straight for the Bellevue Aces, the champions. Have ridden like champions here. And Bladorn, what a ride from him in heat 14. He's had a really disappointing evening, but he comes up with a superb ride there in heat number 14. Congratulations to him. Woofenden threw the kitchen sink at him back in second place, but that really smashing move in the first corner. He found some grip on the inside there and just powered to the front and stayed there. So, terrific ride from the youngster. And Charles Wright coming through in third place as well. That does the business for the Bellevue Aces. And for 47 points, 37, so the 10-point lead. All square on aggregate. Wow. Now, Norwich Bladorn, that is a terrific ride from him. 3 points out in front. Ty Woofenden, 2 points in second. Charles Wright coming through into third place, and nothing for Josh Pickering. Smashing ride from Bladorn here. That was a bit of a turn up for the books, actually, Scott, because he's had a disappointing evening.
Oh, it certainly was. I was looking at his scores just before that race, and he's had a tough night. We know what he's capable of, and got to be honest, Kelv, it's not very often you get to beat a three-time world champion, is it? So that will have gone down in his memory book, but it was a fantastic race. We know how hard Bellevue can be, not just physically, but probably more mentally than anything else. Tough, tough race, but awesome ride for Norwich Bladorn. Fantastic. Abby, over to you.
Scott, thank you. We have got one more heat remaining. It is Bellevue that wins on the night, but heat 15 will still be a cracker. So stay with us. The big heat 15 up next.
Kitty Red, Dan Peely Blue, Ty Wafferman in white, Tobias Musilak in yellow. What a lineup!
Welcome back to the National Speedway Stadium. We still have one heat remaining, but Bellevue have won on the night, 47-37. But there is an aggregate point up for grabs, currently 87 all there. And before we resume with Heat 15 and get the manager's picks, let's just remind you the other motorsport coming your way. It includes British Superbikes there in Thruxton this weekend. You can catch that at 1 o'clock, Eurosport 2. It's round 7 for them. Also round 7 for the Speedway Grand Prix Series. We're in Latvia in Riga and coverage starts 2:30 on Discovery Plus. And then motocross at World Championships is in Sweden, also Discovery Plus, Sunday at midday. There's a great atmosphere here in the National Speedway Stadium, Scotty, and you're with the managers now.
Yeah, I am, mate. It's certainly been a cracker of a meeting. Come to Simon Said, Sheffield team manager first. Simon, you've kind of been a bit of thorn in the side for the Aces. I know you're coming here to go for the win. Couldn't quite get it, but this comes down to the last heat decider and the aggregate bonus point. That's hugely important to you boys.
Yeah, it is important. I think we expected a tough run with Bellevue. They're really flying, so it's been a real good test for us tonight. It's coming down to the last heat. I'd like to avoid superheat if I can, but we'll see how we go.
Yeah, definitely. And just real quick, obviously having Ty in the team tailed off a little bit towards the end, but obviously a great addition to the team.
Yeah, really good. And I think not just the points he scores on track, you know, he's great in the pits. He's helping everybody. He's trying to get everybody with help with the setup and what have you. So he's a great influence around the club. He puts bums on seats and I think we're getting a good return from him on track as well.
And who are you going with in Heat 15 for us, please?
Yeah, we'll go for Ty in white off gate 2 and Toby off 4 in yellow.
Okay, thanks, Simon. Mark, Brady opted to go for Heat 15, obviously anticipating a tough night. Comes down to that bonus point, you've secured the win, but you boys just want to keep pushing on at the front.
Yeah, it's not something we'd normally do, to be quite honest, but obviously, you know, you've got to give yourself every possible chance if necessary. And, you know, yep, we expected a tight match, and obviously it may have chosen to be the right decision. But it's been a great night for racing. You know, it's got my you know, nerves on end, tender edge. But
doesn't happen very often, Mark.
No, it doesn't. But you know, this means a lot. You know, obviously, Wolfie coming in. You know, we know what he brings to a team. You know, we've seen what he did in 2016 with Wolverhampton. So we haven't forgot about those days, and we just don't want it to be repeated.
No, you're not bitter. Who are you going for, Heat 15? What are your runners and riders, please?
We're going Jamin Lindsay in red in gate 1, and Dan Bewley in blue off gate 3.
Thanks, guys. Good luck to both of you. Steady's gone. Back to you, Abby.
Scotty, thank you. Well, so many Bellevue fans out enjoying the action as well, from Sheffield as well. So, great Speedway meeting. But still, the big Heat 15 to go. Let's get the latest. It's been a great meeting in Peterborough. Dave Rowe, what's gone on there now?
Yeah, this one's been an absolute cracker, Abby. Peterborough 2 points in front with 3 heats to go, and look at this for heat number 13 with Emil Seifudinov flying away out in front in white, but Jason Doyle being squeezed out by Chris Harris, who almost gets drawn on the inside there of Seifudinov on the top turn. The Panthers running second and third, Chris Harris and Neil Strich-Neverson, but watch out for Jason Doyle in yellow. Crucial race here for Ipswich, and Doyle trying to bundle his way through against Everson, looking to get through on the inside. Harris almost in the way there on the turns 3 and 4 as Doyle tries to find that gap. Seifudinov checking out in front. He's actually going close to track record pace in Heat 13. And Jason Doyle here going sensationally in between Chris Harris and Niels Christensen for a massive 5-1 there for the Ipswich Witches. They're 2 points in front and they almost won the meeting right here, right now in Heat 14. Dan Thompson and Daniel Hume on a 5-1, only for Ben Cook to produce a superb ride for the Panthers. Passing Daniel Hume on the outside and turning back to the inside to pass Dan Thompson and set up a last heat decider at 41-43. I can tell you Wolverhampton have beaten Leicester in a super heat tonight. That went to a dramatic finale at 45-all. And here's Heat 15 at the East of England Arena with Peterborough needing a 5-1 to win. And they gate on a 5-1. Benjamin Basso and Niels Christensen with Emil Seifudinov in white trying to split them up. But Peterborough at this stage almost on track for victory until the stunning Seifudinov makes it through in the second place. Then gets round the outside. takes on Benjamin Basso on the third and fourth bend, goes round Benjamin Basso. Absolutely stunning stuff there from Emil Saifudinov, completing a 15-point maximum with Jason Doyle going through into third place. Ipswich get through this meeting 47-43. Saifudinov the hero, a full 15-point maximum, and Ipswich march on in the chase for the playoffs. A fabulous meeting, and it finishes Peterborough 43, Ipswich 47.
Another important win for the Witches. It sounds like there's been brilliant speedway all across the country, and we've got one heat remaining at the National Speedway Stadium. Hand you over to Calvin for the last time this evening. Maybe.
Yeah, maybe indeed, Abby. We could well have a super heat for the aggregate point if it's a 3-all at the conclusion of heat number 15. Fabulous speedway in Peterborough there. Ipswich on a roll. They've won three times on the road, and they are making their presence felt. There's no question about that. Fair play to them. But all eyes have been on this man a lot tonight. Of course, Ty Woofenden, who comes out for his sixth ride tonight. He's been a busy boy. There's no question about that. He's certainly put his best foot forward tonight. Can he produce something stunning here? But it's not going to be easy with Lidsey and Bewley in there for the Bellevue Aces, who have done a great job this evening, no doubt about that. They've won the evening, but it's all about that bonus point, really, right now. Any heat advantage to the home team and they will get it. Heat number 15 then. Jamin Lidsey off the inside in red. Ty Woofenden will come out of gate number 2 in white. Dan Bewley from gate number 3 in blue. And Tobias Michalak will go from the outside in the yellow helmet colour. Almost an action replay of heat 13. Brady Kurtz hasn't quite managed to make heat 15. Lidsey comes in there with three race victories this evening and one third place. He's done a great job for the Bellevue Aces. And it's been a super night of speedway. As I say, the Ipswich Witches have certainly beginning to make their presence felt, but Bellevue Aces on same points coming into tonight with five meetings in hand. They need it to win tonight. They can not rest on their laurels or two at all. They've got 2 points in the bag. Will they make it three? Or will we have to have a race off, a super heat for the aggregate point? We've already had one on Eurosport this year. So don't go anywhere, people. This might not be the last 4 laps of the evening. Heat number 15 then. Stays up, runs away. Woofenden's made a smashing start from gate number 2. He fires himself there around the inside as they see with Bewley being certainly hustled wide there. Now, Ty Woofenden under all sorts of pressure. Bewley just going into a different county round the outside. Certainly now trying to wind it on. Jamin Lidsey out in front, riding superbly well. Michalak's there right alongside Ty Woofenden. Certainly now Bewley trying to hunt them down, deciding and electing to go to the inside. Bewley! Oh, what a move from him! Up the inside of Ty Woofenden, neck and neck down the back straight. That will seal the deal for Bellevue on the aggregate. Bewley. Oh my goodness, he was nowhere on the first lap. Now he's come through into second place, a stunning heat once again. Michalak trying to come back at him down the back straight. One last blast through the final turn. Lidsey wins it, a massive 5-1, and what a conclusion to the night. The fans are just overjoyed, on their feet. Fabulous speedway. Really was. That's what it's all about, people. That really was a demonstration of top draw speedway in heat number 15. Lidsey doing the business out in front, and Dan Bewley, when we see the replays, he was just tailed off at the back, elected to go wide, generated the speed, switched back to the inside, and came through in the second place. Stunning stuff indeed. So many congratulations to the Bellevue Aces. They pick up all the points tonight, 3 points for them. As I say, a rounding applause there for the Bellevue Aces. So the result of heat 15, Lidsey out in front, 3 points for him. Bewley back in second place, 2 points. Tobias Michalak back in third, and Ty Woofenden missing out in heat number 15. Wow, Scotty, this was some conclusion to the night. This was spectacular.
It certainly was, Kel. We're possibly anticipating a super heat, especially at this point right here. It could have gone a 3-all, potentially even a 4-2 or even a 5-1 for the Sheffield Tigers, but that man you spoke about, Dan Bewley, he's way at the back, but he's calm, he doesn't panic. just winds up like a clock on the outside, just builds up so much speed and momentum. Ty Whiffen looked like he was possibly struggling a little bit there, lacking the speed, and I think him and Michalek kind of messed each other up a little bit, and that allowed the Aces to romp away to a 5-1. I've got to be honest, Kelv, if these two boys are in the playoffs, which I'm pretty sure they will be, I think you're going to have to go shopping for a bigger top draw, mate.
Okay, I'll get down to IKEA quick. Anyway, yeah. Here comes Bewley. What a stunning move. He gets the better of Wiffenden, and then how did he do this to get back up the inside of Michalek?
It was fantastic, Kelvin. I have to be honest, I think that's where Dan being so much lighter just really, really helps. But Dan Bewley, fantastic. 5-1, big night for the Aces. What have you got for us, Abby?
Well, just want to repeat what you said. It's Speedway out of the top draw, isn't it? Just an amazing performance from Dan Bewley, going from fourth to second. We're going to have more analysis after this. Welcome back to the National Speedway Stadium. It's been a brilliant night of Speedway, but for the Aces, they've aced it this evening. 52-38 is the final result. They take away all 3 points because they also picked up the aggregate bonus point. A reminder of the other sport that's happening. So much great sport across the channel, includes UCI Cycling World Championships. Tomorrow, 12:25, Eurosport 2. That's at Glasgow. It's day 6 of the championships. Football, the Premier League is back. And and it will start on TNT Sports 1, 12th of August, 11 a.m. The coverage starts, and it's between Arsenal and Nottingham Forest, and kickoff is at 12:30. And then you've also got the Athletics World Championships there in Budapest, Eurosport Live, 19th to the 27th of August. This is what the championship standings in Speedway now look like. Looks like it's Bellevue at the top, an important win tonight. Wolverhampton are in second, Leicester in third, Ipswich in fourth. Ipswich on a run now, that's their third away win on the bounce. Sheffield Tigers in fifth, Kings Lynn sixth, and Peterborough Panthers at the bottom of the table. Let's join Scott Nichols now. He's with Jamin Lindsay.
Yeah, thanks, Abby. I'm with Jamin. Jamin, an awesome performance by the Aces. You secured the bonus point, a stellar night for yourself. But did you have any idea what was going on behind you in Heat 15?
No, I didn't. I made a pretty good start off gate one. Gate one kind of went off towards the end. It goes quite dry, but, you know, I felt like I made a good one. Wolfie got across me, and, you know, I managed to find something on that turn three and four there, and, you know, just hooked up and went. So I'm pretty happy that happened. But, yeah, as I come in and seen there was plenty going on behind me.
I was just say, just before we come on here, we're having a look at the replays, and it was carnage behind you. I think the Sheffield boys possibly kind of hampered each other a little bit, allowed Dan that big run around the outside.
Yeah, possibly, but, you know, Dan, he's got a lot of track craft here, and, you know, he went out wide, and, you know, it looks like he lost a bit of ground the first time he went out, but, you know, he built that speed up and, you know, managed to get a good cut back and, split both the other boys and, you know, and finish a meeting like that's always great. You know, that's why the people pay to come see.
They certainly do. Lemo's been a racer himself, and he's a good team manager, but you must have been feeling the heat, a little bit of the pressure during the meeting. What was Lemo saying during the breaks?
Not too much, really. We only got together when we had that bit of an interval, but, you know, he kind of puts his trust in everyone. You know, we're here to do a job. We're all capable of scoring points, and, you know, it's just got to do it on the same night. You know, it's a speedway, as you know, it's quite tough, you know. You got to take it when it's good, and when it's bad, you need to bounce back and, you know, try fight back, and, you know, your day always comes in the end. But, you know, great night, great win for the team, and, get the bonus point.
It does make you the defending champions. How important is it for you boys to kind of keep that momentum going and go into those playoffs strong, because it's a fresh slate there?
Yeah, for sure. Playoffs is a new game. We've done a lot more meetings than anyone else. So, you know, we're on top of the table now, but we'll see what happens. You know, I think Leicester have got 4 or 5 more meetings behind us. So, you know, they've got a few to catch up on. But, yeah, playoffs is a new game, and we've got to be focused coming into there.
Well, thanks for chatting to you, mate. Thank you very much. Over to you, Abby.
Scott, thank you. What a great night of Speedway. I just saw Dan Bewley. He's wearing sombreros, eating watermelon. Just life's a dream for the young Cumbrian. We'll be back here in 7 days' time. It is the British final. Dan Bewley will be back to defend his title. Make sure you enjoy the coverage and see us then.